look out across the water. I smell the sun, I feel the breeze, but in my heart
I mean when I say intentions, how would I believe in thoughts are my product of reasoning? My eyes are relaxed, but my head's got them leading the way. It's not often I've arranged things, and it's not
rounders, and a story I'll tell promise of heaven and the warning of hell. But take heed where you ramble, or too soon you will go way up on the hillside where the new flowers grow. Well, he met in the springtime, the sun sinking low. Two star-crossed lovers in the still-melting snow. Well, the loving was easy and the courting was brief. Well, they called her a beauty, called him a thief. In the quiet of the evening, they'd steal away where the laughter would flow and the fiddle would play. Well, the folks called it wrong, but hell, it seemed all right. In the sun-painted picture, and the day turned to night. Come up on the hillside, we'll have a time. If you'll bring the kisses, honey, I'll bring the wine. Keep your heart guarded, too soon it'll fall. When one walks back home, honey, only one knows it all. Well, she walked up the hillside, alone one day. If the heart is a hunter, always knows of its prey. And her father's old pistol hanging loose by her side. When she aimed once, she never shot twice. Well, the air was so still, and the sky was so blue, before she could see them, laughter she knew. She heard two shots ring out down in the town. There was three on the hillside, but only one headed down. I was just a baby, walked up the hillside, saw two mounds of clay. I'll always remember, and I'll never go back up the hillside where the new flowers grow. Back up the hillside, new flowers grow.
See where she's going.
fame, what it seems. There's still a part of me that's trying. Come lay on my chest, you can find a little rest from hiding. Don't let this go, don't let it fall away. Don't worry, we'll take it slow. Just don't.
Can find a way. I we can find a way to stand up, stand up, stand up.
Uniting the races with truth instead of dividing them with lies. We're also rebuilding the family by rebuilding the man. I am Jesse Lee Peterson. Welcome to the show. I hope that you had a nice, relaxing socialist communist day yesterday and over the weekend. It was called Labor Day. And some of you traveling here and there, to and for, near, whatever. I hope you have a safe trip. Mine were nice. We did the show yesterday, and afterward, I did a little work around the office. And then I went and had some good steak and yams, or sweet potato. Man, it was delicious. No pumpkin, but sweet potato. Amazing, huh? You can get involved by calling 888-777-5373. 888-77-JESSE. We have every way that you can watch and support the show listed on jesseleepeterson.com/show. jesseleepeterson.com/show. What is that screen up there all about? What's happening with that? There's a flickering screen in front. Now that one went out. We have every way that you can watch. They're working on it, folks. It's just a little distraction for me. We have every way that you can watch and support the show listed on jesseleepeterson.com/show. jesseleepeterson.com/show. And if you're out and about, you can listen to the show. And you're busy, you're traveling back home. You're stuck in the airport. You're swimming across the borders. Since there are Chinese and people from all over the world coming into our country now across the border. And I think they get Obama's cell phone to make an appointment to come to court 10 years from now. Something like that. I don't know exactly how it went. And you're listening to the show on your iPhone or cell phone. I mean, your iPhone or iPad. You can call the listen line at 641-793-1500. 641-793-1500. And don't forget to follow us on Rumble. On rumble.com/JesseLeePeterson. And Jesse Lee Peterson on Instagram. Ring the bell, subscribe, like, follow. It's amazing. It really is amazing. So I have a brand new biblical question for you this week. And it's another doozy. Brand new biblical question. Brand new. What is your state of mind? What is your state of mind? What is it? Your state of mind is what? Do you ever ask yourself that? What is my state of mind? What is my state of mind? Do you ever ask yourself that? Even if no one ever asks you, do you ever ask, know thyself? I cannot begin to explain what will happen to you if you start to really know yourself. There are no words to express, but to my best ability, you will overcome if you stay with it, the false self. It's unfortunately, in a way, in that you've been living in darkness, I have been living in darkness, all people live in darkness until they start to question themselves, know thyself. It's amazing. Know yourself. It's going to blow your mind. Didn't I blow your mind this time? Didn't I? So it's Tuesday. And every Tuesday is Country and Western Tuesday.
When I was a little bitty baby, my mama used to rob me in her crater. In that old cotton field back home. It was down in Louisiana, just about a mile from Texas County. In that old cotton field back home.
Amazing! Country and Western Tuesday!
Amazing. Country and Western Tuesday. Country. I grew up on that music. It was amazing. So let me explain all this stuff here. I don't know what this is. So when I was growing up, as you know, I lived on a plantation, right? And we had to feed the animals, bring them up to the barn. As a matter of fact, I lived right across the road from the barn. So I would have to get up and go over there and take care of the horses and things. And as a result, my grandfather gave me two horses, and I used to ride them to go see my girlfriend and on Sunday evenings and sometime weekends, and ride them to go and bring the cows in from the pasture, stuff like that. But I have never had all this stuff. This doesn't even look like me at all, right? But what happened is there's a friend of Bond and of the fellowship and the organization. He's from Mexico. And I think this is what they used to do in Mexico. I never had a thing on the back. I don't even know what that is. I had a saddle. And so all this. Hola. Daniel from Mexico, he really liked what we're doing here. He supported. He liked it. So he's kind of adding to it. And they're giving it a Mexican look, not a black look. And I understand it. Thank you, man. But it just ain't me. I've never carried wood on a mule with two crosses. It is a cross, right? Crosses.
I think it's just like support.
For the wood?
Just traveling support.
Oh. I just simply rode a horse. But I appreciate the love that's being shown here. I really do as a support. But it's more of what the Mexican did than what we did. Right?
I suppose so.
Huh?
I suppose so, yeah.
Oh, amazing. So thank you, Daniel, but... You're taking the joke too far now. I don't even know why this rope is on the horse head up here. What's this supposed to be?
It's complex. it's sold separately.
Amazing. Anyway, 888-775-3773. Before I go to the calls and the super chats, I want to give you an example of what human nature look like. There are two natures, an abnormal one and a normal one, right? And the abnormal one is human nature, the fallen nature. And in the fallen nature, the abnormal one, we do weird things. All people do. Every human being does. Because every human being ends up falling into the human nature, which is evil, by the way. There's no love in it. It's pure evil. It's selfish. And it doesn't know what to do with itself. It doesn't know what to do with itself. Just think about you, yourself, just you, not someone else. But think about yourself. Does your life make sense? Do you ever wonder to yourself, does my life make sense? I'm all confused and scared and looking for this and looking for that and thinking this is going to work and that going to work and this going to, and it never does. If I got more of this, it would be better. If I got more of this or that, it would be better, and it never does. If I got married, I'll be happy. If I didn't get married, I'll be happy. Both are lies. Have you ever wondered if my life makes sense? And have you ever wondered why all human natures, all human beings do the same thing? Some deviate in different situations a little bit, but it's the same spirit. They do the same thing, and then they judge others not seeing that they're doing the same thing. Maybe a little different situation, but it's the same. So I want to show you an example of all human beings. This is a different situation in some cases, but it's the same thing as what you're doing in your life. All human beings. Human nature is evil. And yet it's so promoted, and it's so people try to make it work. They try to make it work, and they can't. You try to make your human nature work, and it doesn't. It only gets worse. It keeps you going in circles, thinking that the next thing is better. If you want to be free, you need to pay attention to yourself. But if you love your hell and love trying to inflict hell on others, then you can just suffer and die. It's up to you. There's this word called ultimatum. I give you an ultimatum. An ultimatum means that, you know what? Either you're going to do it or you're not. If not, I'm out of here. Oxford gave a definition for ultimatum. It is a final demand or statement of terms, the rejection of which will result in retaliation or a breakdown in relationship. In other words, one person in a couple says, we're either getting married soon or we're done. Have you ever had anyone give you an ultimatum? Either you do what I say or it's over. Either you do what I say or this marriage is over. Either you do what I say, I'm the parent, you're the child. And either you do what I say or I'm taking your toys. Either you marry me, I'm out of here. Well, apparently there's a movie called Ultimatum. I mean, it's a TV show. I've never personally seen it. My producer have seen it, and he said it was so interesting. It's a good example of human nature. Wikipedia define human. No, this is from Wikipedia. The Ultimatum is a reality TV series that want to see how many couples will get married when presented with an ultimatum. Am I saying that right, Sean? I mean, Hassan?
Ultimatum.
Ultimatum. I'm like, and slow. Have you ever seen this show?
I haven't, but a friend of mine actually just was talking to me about it.
Oh, yeah? The show featured couples on the verge of marriage. And so what they do, they bring all these people in this house, couples who are together, and they are on the verge of marriage. And either they're going to get married or they're going to split up. Each pair has 8 weeks to decide whether they want to get married or split forever. Let me show you the soundbite of it from Netflix. Watch this.
We've been together since we were 16 years old.
I find it hard to believe in one true love.
If he's unsure about marrying me, then what am I doing?
Yeah.
Someone in the relationship has issued an ultimatum.
It's time for us to get engaged and get married, or it's time for me to move on.
That's why I'm giving Alex an ultimatum.
You will each choose a new partner. You move in together for 3 weeks in the trial marriage.
I'm going home. You sitting there talking to the Pooters.
Holy moly.
You see who's the problem?
You're the problem.
Clearly I am.
You're the problem.
Wow.
This is that opportunity for me to give you reassurance, but you're not giving me that chance.
She's very independent. Can you handle that?
Very independent, yes.
Yes, I did catch feelings, but the feelings I have for you never went away.
Does Ryan know everything about your past?
Not exactly.
So I feel like James should be scared of losing me.
I want those butterflies like I had in the beginning.
This shit is hard.
She informed us that she had taken a pregnancy test.
Oh, my God.
I can't do it anymore.
I'm done.
What do you think about that?
Man, what a mess.
But the thing about it is, if they're all in one house and there are TV cameras all around watching everything they do and somebody producing the show, how do they know that it's not all an act? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, if it's not an act, you're right. It's at least influenced to get some sort of kind of reaction out of people purposely.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not like, even though it does symbolizes real life in the human nature, life, people do go to that. Sean, come here for a minute and explain this, since I have not seen it. People do these things in life, couples do, either you marry me now, and it's natural for ladies to want to get married. It's a natural thing for women want to get married. But how do they know, Sean? This is my producer, Sean, and he's seen this TV series. How do they know these people are not just acting?
I mean, yeah, like I think James mentioned, you know, they might be hamming it up for the cameras.
Right.
But they are real relationships and they are real people. And, you know, with reality TV shows, you never know how much the producers script what they want to say stuff. But, you know, you got to assume at least some of it is real.
And then what is it that they want to do? Trying to prove on the show.
I mean,
go ahead.
They're trying to delve deep into what goes on when people present ultimatums to their partner.
But the last week or two, 3 weeks or so, from what you told me, is that they split the couples up, that each couple has to go with the other person.
Right. So they come onto the show. These couples come on. One of them has presented the other with an ultimatum. They say either you're going to marry me. Sometimes it's the guy, sometimes it's the girl. So they say, you know, either you marry me or we're done. And so they go onto the show and with these other couples and they split up, they start dating each other, you know, and then they pick a different person to live with for 3 weeks as a trial marriage with a different person, with a new person. So it's a way of, I guess, reconsidering what they think of their original partner.
Well, people don't normally do that, right, if they're not on camera.
Some people do. In fact, the people who host the show, Nick Lachey and his wife, that's what they did. They were dating for 4 or 5 years. They weren't sure. And then they decided, we're going to go date other people for a month. And then they ended up getting back together and getting married.
That's with Jessica Simpson?
No, his wife, I forget her name. I don't know what she's famous for, but...
Didn't he used to be married to Jessica Simpson?
I'm not sure, but I wouldn't be surprised.
Hey,
what's his name?
Nick Lachey.
From 98 Degrees.
But, you know, the whole show is about talking about, you know, their emotions and what they really need from each other and, you know, why they're not getting married, stuff like that.
Amazing.
I wish I could show you more scenes from the show.
Right.
So you could see the kind of things that they talk about. But classic things we always talk about. The female will often on the show say something like, oh, by the way, they're drinking the entire time. You know what I mean?
Oh, they are.
Oh, yeah. They're getting drunk. Yeah, and that'll add to the drama. But the female in the relationship will often say, well, I need you to be more emotional. You know, that's why we're not working well enough. I need you to be more vulnerable with me to the guy in the relationship. And sometimes it's the guy who says that, you know, I need more validation from you. I need you to open up to me more and show that you love me.
Oh, man.
So,
well, that's mere human nature.
Yeah. I mean, the entire time I was watching it, you know, your whole message was the only thing I was thinking about.
Right. I see.
It was unbelievable.
Yeah. What the?
Yeah.
I'm reading notes. Nick says that, yes, he used to be married to Jessica Simpson, but he doesn't say where you get that information from, so I still don't know if it's true or not.
Yeah.
And then, hey, oh, you see that note from Pete? Okay. Amazing.
So there's two seasons so far.
Oh, okay. It looks like one of those reality shows thing.
It is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it is.
And so how does it end? Have you ever seen the ending of it?
Yep, I watch both seasons.
How does it end? You watch both seasons? How does it end?
A lot of couples end up getting back together with their original partner, and some of them split up. Some of them are still figuring it out, working on their relationship. One of them gets pregnant. Obviously, you can see in the trailer there, one of them ends up getting pregnant. They're together, but they're still not married.
Amazing. I didn't know the one was pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Hassan, can you play that Netflix one over again?
Yes, sir.
Did you adjust my mic yet?
I turned Sean down a little bit.
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Been together since we were 16 years old.
I find it hard to believe in one true love.
If he's unsure about marrying me, then what am I doing?
Yeah.
Someone in the relationship has issued an ultimatum.
It's time for us to get engaged and get married, or it's time for me to move on.
That's why I'm giving Alex an ultimatum.
You will each choose a new partner. You move in together for 3 weeks in the trial marriage.
I'm going home. You sitting there talking to the Hooters.
Holy moly.
You see who's the problem?
You're the problem.
Clearly I am.
You're the problem.
Wow.
This is that opportunity for me to give you reassurance, but you're not giving me that chance.
She's very independent. Can you handle that?
Very independent, yes.
Yes, I did catch feelings, but the feelings I have for you never went away.
Does Ryan know everything about your past?
Not exactly.
So I feel like James should be scared of losing me.
I want those butterflies like I had in the beginning.
This shit is hard.
She informed us that she had taken a pregnancy test.
Oh, oh my God.
I can't do it anymore.
I'm done.
Another thing that's not real about this movie is that, you know, men don't be dressing up like that every morning, every day. Makeup and nice clothes.
That's one of the things I was wondering. I was like, do they set up these clothes for them? Do they choose their own? But they, you know, they choose their new partners. They go and meet their family. They talk to their parents. You know, they have the whole experience of what it would be like to be in an actual relationship with this new person.
Uh-huh.
And then, you know, you add a couple drinks. You know, you could see them in the trailer. They all got their drinks in their hand. add a couple drinks, add a couple feelings, and it's a recipe for disaster.
Human nature is a mess. So according to Hate, Jessica Simpson was married to Nick. Nick what?
Nick Lachey.
Nick Lachey from 2002 to 2006. They divorced per Wikipedia. Jesse Simpson reported, one thing about hate, he won't stop giving me information. Jesse Simpson reportedly had to pay Nick Lachey $12 million in divorce since she had not signed a prenuptial. She later called her marriage to Lachey her biggest financial mistake, according to Wikipedia. So at least the women know what it feels like when they be ripping the men off. When they have to pay, they understand what it must feel like for the man when they are going to court and the man has to pay them alimony and all that crap. He got $12 million. Good for him.
Yep. She got a taste of her own medicine.
I'm telling you, it's the same thing about these women complaining about men playing in women's sport while at the same time they want women to play in men's sport. What's the difference? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're complaining about what's happening to them while at the same time they're doing it to men.
Yep.
Amazing.
You know, they kind of started, not that this is important, but they kind of started the reality TV show world.
Who?
Jessica Simpson and Nick Lachey. They had a reality show about their marriage and stuff.
Prior to this show?
Back in early 2000s.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, they were kind of the
original
show in the mess of the marriage and dynamics and stuff.
What?
So it's kind of it's fitting that he's now hosting this ultimatum mess.
I don't even know who y'all talking about. I might probably recognize him if I saw a picture, but
he was in a boy band in the.
He was a musician.
90s, yeah, like Backstreet Boys, NSYNC.
Oh, I thought he was an actor.
Right. There's a group called 98 Degrees.
Amazing, 98 Degrees. Okay.
Yep. Enough pointless information for me.
And a lot of people go on the show just to be famous. You know, they go on there to put their face out there, and hopefully something else will come out of it. But I don't know. I assume maybe 50% of it is scripted, 50% is real.
Amazing. Still. Thank you, man.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it. What a mess. Human nature is a mess. Human nature is a mess. Thank you, Hate, for all that other information that I didn't want or need it. Or Hate is white. He's white. He said, yeah, you're welcome. I want to go to human nature is a mess. If you want to be free, you got to overcome human nature instead of worshiping it. You got to overcome it. This is abnormal nature. You must be born again of the Spirit of the Father. Cray is a first-time caller. And there's one line open at 888-775-3773. Craig is a first-time caller out of Denver, Colorado. Craig, welcome to the show. You're on the air.
Good morning, Jesse.
Hey, Craig. Oh, I'm sorry, Craig. Can you hold? Let me take a quick break.
Hello. Okay.
I didn't realize we were there like that. Hello. 888-77 Jesse. Quick break. When I come back, your phone calls and super chats. Back in a moment. Left many years ago, and now I sit here at the bar, feeling so alone. I've read all of the books I have and walked the planet round, but still the thing I'm looking for refuses to be found. Except this claim. I have books that are amazing. I highly recommend you get them. 7 Guaranteed Steps to Spiritual, Family, and Financial Success Guide. Even if you're not starting a business, but you have a job, or you're on welfare, it can help you if you do. Be doers of the word, all right? From rage to responsibility, from rage. That's what I write about in the first chapter, especially how I overcame. Scam. how the black leadership exploits black Americans. They're using them, and blacks are too willing to be used. And then my last book, The Antidote, Healing America from the Poison of Hate, Blame, and Victimhood. They are all amazing books, and they are helpful. Go to RebuildingTheMan.com if you want an autographed copy, or call 800-411-2663. All right, folks, welcome back. 888-775-3773. Quick announcement. After my show, thehakereport.com, thehake, H-A-K-E, report.com, from 9 to 11 a.m. Pacific time. And then at 11 a.m., Joel Friday TV, Ebrat. Joel Friday TV at 11 a.m. At 12 noon today, after Joel Friday TV, the American Anchor Baby. The American Anchor Baby at 12 noon. So a lot going on. And don't forget to donate and have your comments read out loud. You can go to buymeacoffee.com/Jesse Lee Peterson. buymeacoffee.com/JLP Talk. All right. buymeacoffee.com/JLP Talk. And you can also support us by going to Bond JLP on Cash App. Bond JLP on Cash App. I think that's right. Yeah. Amazing. I want to go back to Craig, a first-time caller out of Colorado. Craig, let's try it again. Go ahead.
Okay, yeah. Well, you know, my original question had to do with Jesus and how, you know, some people talk about him all the time, and then other people, they don't bring his name up, but yet they appear to be representing him nonetheless. And after you were talking a while there, I was kind of thinking of a couple of other questions to throw in there. And I guess my first question is, when you were on the plantation, when you were growing up, how did you meet Jesus?
How did I meet Jesus?
Or did you already know him? Is it
what does that mean? I don't understand that. How do you meet Jesus?
Well, that's kind of at the Billy Graham Crusade, when you go down to the altar and you become transformed. Doesn't happen to everybody, though.
Did that happen to you?
Not at Billy Graham, but I used to listen to all the televangelists all the time when I was growing up.
And you met?
And they'd say,
"No, go ahead."
You know, Pat Robertson and Ben,
right?
And I'd be out partying, and then I'd come on inside and all hungry and gooped up. And I'd listen to them, and nothing would happen. But it made me feel better to pray along with them on the TV.
Right. And so did you meet Jesus?
I did, but not there. I met him in church.
And how did you meet him? How did you meet him in church?
I think I met him through other people, because I went up to the altar, and I just went up out of obedience, and just I raised my hands. These little church ladies were praying for me. This man, Anson, I'll never forget him. He had such a loving heart. And they prayed a prayer with me, and I don't remember the specifics of the prayer, but all of a sudden I felt kind of like a little jolt of electricity, kind of like a brrr. It kind of went through me, and I was changed from that day. And so it became not just knowing about God, but actually I felt as if I was in communion.
And so you met Jesus that day?
I believe so.
And you met him with that little thing that went through you, you say?
Well, the evidence that I had was I was different the very next day. I wanted to clean the house. I was just on fire. And of course, a lot of that was connected with getting into that church, I guess. But I still felt as if though I had changed. There was a transformation in my life.
And you changed from what to what?
Somebody who didn't know him to someone who met him, I'm guessing. I'm not sure. I just knew that I felt a little bit more empathetic to people. I felt a little bit more loving. I wanted to learn the Bible. Started going to Bible studies and studying.
So you became...
It wasn't all uphill. I mean, I had many relapses, but...
So you changed intellectually?
I don't think so. No. It wasn't intellectual.
And so are you still changed?
I believe the change is still there, but I believe it's because of his grace, not because of my...
And so
not
you
because
believe,
of my efforts.
What change is there right now?
What change? Being more open and loving to other people, not being so selfish, not conflating Jesus with politics necessarily. Although there are some principles in politics that are strong Christian principles and that we need to uphold, but I'd say on an individual level, it's just being more open to other people, feeling a compassion to teach them what I know, which, I mean, to be honest, isn't much. I couldn't have my own show, but I don't know.
Amazing. And so your question for me is what about that?
Well, originally my question was going to be, because you're a man, you don't bring Jesus up a lot, but it seems like you have homespun wisdom that's just spiritually discerned. And I just wonder what your take is on it. I mean, do you think it's more important to live Christ in you as a communion lifestyle than it is just to say his name all the time and try and use that?
I have to admit, Craig, I don't know what your question is. All the language you use doesn't make sense. But because I've heard the language so much, you want to become a living being, not just talking about the name of Jesus, because the people who just talk about the name of Jesus, Jesus this and Jesus that, they're just intellectually talking about him, but within themselves, they don't know him. They're not a living example. That's why they threw out his name so much, because they don't want you to see that they're not a living example. It's just words. Just words, okay. Just speeches.
I guess it would be somewhat similar if we went to a basketball game and we met LeBron, and then we told everybody about LeBron, but we never really even knew LeBron. We just met him and got an autograph.
100%. A perfect, perfect analogy. They just know about him intellectually, and they don't know him at all. They just know about what someone said or what they read. So they just know him intellectually in the imagination. And that's why it's holding them back from knowing the Father, because they don't really know the Son. They just know about him.
Well, thanks, Jesse. I appreciate that encouragement and insight.
Have you heard me say, go and forgive your mother and father?
Yes.
Have you done that?
Well, they're both passed, but I have. I've done so in prayer.
Meaning what?
Well, my father's the one that I needed to forgive more. My mother was a sweetie. I don't really need to forgive her for nothing. She was just being human.
So the sweetie didn't do anything?
Pardon?
The sweetie didn't do anything wrong?
I mean, sure she did, but so is everybody else. I'm not...
No, you know. Said there was nothing to forgive your mother for. She was just a sweetie. So you're saying the sweetie...
No, she didn't do anything wrong.
So the sweetie never did anything wrong?
Oh, no. I wouldn't say
so. But you're
so.
Talking out both sides of your mouth. You're saying that I didn't have to forgive my mother. She was just a sweetie. My father's who I had to forgive. So which implied that the sweetie, mama, never did anything wrong, right?
I mean, if I was in court trying to defend her, I wouldn't bring up everything she done. I would just answer questions.
But you're saying that the sweetie did nothing wrong, right?
She did.
So why do you say she didn't?
Because I forgave her.
But you said the sweetie never did nothing wrong to forgive her for.
Well, I mean, the only thing she did to me, if I could say was wrong, is she spoiled me too much.
And so would a sweetie spoil the child?
I don't know.
Yes, you do.
I mean, she was too easy on me.
Would a sweetie spoil the child?
No.
And so why you think you don't need to forgive her for that?
Well, maybe it's myself I need to forgive for taking advantage of her.
You know, how you going to take advantage? You were the child. The adult was spoiling you.
No, but you got to understand, I was a child up until I was 50.
Right, but she has set you up to be what you became.
Yes. And that might have not been perfect. When you say she never done nothing wrong, that might not have been the best textbook way of being a mom.
Was it the perfect?
Pardon? The
was
purpose?
Was it the right thing for her to do that?
I don't know.
Yes, you do.
I mean, it is what it is, you know.
Was it the right thing for her to do that? Spoil you like that and mess up your life all the way up to 50.
Well, I was the one that took advantage of it.
Was it the right thing for her to do that?
I don't think it was wrong.
Was it the right thing for her to do that?
She could. If I'd had a tougher mom, different results would have happened in my life.
Was it the right thing for your mother to do to spoil you like that?
Probably not.
Was it the right thing for your mother to do to spoil you like that?
Probably not, but I forgive her.
Was it the right thing for your mother to do to spoil you like that?
Not sure I understand. I mean, are you saying that she could have done it better?
Was?
Spoiled me better?
Was it the right thing for your mother to do to spoil you like that?
I don't know.
Yes, you do. Was it the right thing for her to do?
I mean, I'm just going to have to say yes.
So it was the right thing for the sweetie to spoil you?
I needed the attention.
Was it? You said it was the right thing for the sweetie to do to spoil you?
I really, you know, I mean, if I'd had a tougher mother, I would have probably felt differently about, well, it has to do with my father. He's the one that really was the spoiler. He spoiled me. And yet there were some things that went on. You know, everybody's got their skeletons.
So was it the right thing for your mother, the sweetie mama, to spoil you?
Jesus probably wouldn't spoil me.
Was it the right thing for your sweetie mama to spoil you?
Well, I always called her sweetie.
Was it the right thing for sweetie mama to spoil you?
I don't know, Jesse. I really don't know. Maybe you think I do, but I'm not sure which way to go on this one.
Why not? You don't know if it was right or wrong.
Well, I mean, I know that other people would say it was wrong.
But what would you say?
I would say she did the best she could.
Was it right or wrong for her to spoil you?
Yes.
It was right?
It was right, even though I had to learn some tough lessons because of it.
And when you say you took advantage of her spoiling you, what do you mean by that?
That means I got lazy and codependent on her.
And so has she not spoiled you, would you have done that?
No, I mean, emotionally, I'd still, I relied on her. I counted on her, but I would have gotten tougher.
Has she not spoiled you, would you have done that?
Done what?
Relied on her and took advantage and been lazy and all that.
I would have always relied on her.
If she had not spoiled you, would you have relied on her, got lazy, and took advantage of it?
No. I would not have gotten lazy, and I would not have taken advantage of her.
So was it right for her to spoil you?
Well, I've learned.
And so was it right for her to spoil you?
I mean, she wasn't really big on Jesus.
For her to spoil you?
If I said yes, it would mean that I feel a sense of entitlement.
Was it right for her to spoil you?
I think she was trying to make up for my dad.
Was it right for her to spoil you?
I don't know.
Would you have gotten fat and lazy and taken advantage had she not spoiled you?
No.
So then was it right for her to spoil you?
No.
I'm sorry?
No.
Why is it so hard to say that?
Because I don't want to admit that she did something wrong.
How will you be free? How will you be able to forgive her if you don't face that?
Okay. Is that a point?
No, that was a question.
I have to be honest. Honesty is the first step of forgiveness.
How
right?
will you be able to forgive her if you don't admit it that she was wrong for doing that?
Okay, I get your point.
No, it was a question.
I couldn't, could I? I mean, how would I forgive her? I mean, I would have to accept that I was wrong for accepting it. I would have to accept that I was wrong.
No, you wouldn't.
Advantage.
You couldn't help yourself. You was a kid. You was accepted to her.
I was 50.
She knew what she was doing. She spoiled you from kid to 50?
Yeah, almost. She bailed me out of a lot of problems.
How old are you now?
63.
And she took care of you until you were 50?
Well, I took care of her the last few years.
But she took care of you until you were 50?
In a way.
Amazing. And because of time, what do you need to forgive your father for? What did he do to you?
My father was guilty of emotional incest.
What's emotional incest?
Well, it just means that he was very close to me. I was his boy. And he spoiled me by giving me money all the time, but he wouldn't give me intimacy. He didn't know how to express intimacy. And he didn't know how to be close to his son.
He didn't. And where did you get your intimacy from?
Friends.
And your mama.
And mama.
And so your father took care of you financially. He fed you. He put a roof over your head, but he wasn't intimacy with you?
He just didn't know how to be close. He didn't know how to open up.
Well, what do you need to do all that for? He was taking care of you, and there was nothing to open up to you about.
Well, I mean, even like you, you're being open with me, and you're, like, giving me advice and stuff.
I'm not giving you advice. I'm asking you questions.
Okay.
why do you need him to over? You were getting too much from your mama, and look what she did to you with all of her intimacy. It made you weak.
Maybe I didn't know how to be strong. Maybe I didn't want to be strong.
No, you did. Your mama made sure you would not be strong, and so you can think that she was a little sweetie, and that your dad was the bad guy. She set you up. She hated your father, and she turned you away from him, and you think she was a sweetie when she was the devil.
Well, it's kind of interesting, because when she got Alzheimer's later in life, she forgot who he was.
She wanted to forget in life, too. But her hatred wouldn't let her forget.
Yeah.
You didn't need your father to be enemy, Marcy. That doesn't even make sense. When I was growing up, my father or grandfather was not enemy, Marcy, but they took care of us. And we knew from that they loved us. We didn't need all that emotional crap that come from mama, which is from hell, by the way. Are you fat now?
Pardon?
Are you fat?
Yes. Am I fat?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm getting older. It's coming off slowly, but yeah.
You fat, right?
Yeah.
That come from sweetie mama babying you.
Well, now I baby myself sometimes, and right. That's the problem.
You became like your mama. She set you up. Though mama is dead, she still lives in you.
Yes. But Jesus lives in me.
Mama lives in you. Jesus ain't there. That's mama.
Food for thought, Jesse.
So you wanted your daddy to treat you the way your mama treated you?
No.
Well, then why are you complaining that he was an intimacy more? He didn't know how to... He was emotionally intimacy or whatever you said. Why you wanted him to be that way?
I didn't know.
What?
I fought against it.
Against what?
Before I was at 9 or 10, I was his little boy. And, I mean, I was pals together and all this stuff. And I was more intimate with him than I was with her.
But you wanted your mama to be intimacy with you.
Yeah, but then they'd say, well, that's not right.
It's not.
They'd say,
look what it did to you. Look what it done to you. Because of time, here's what I recommend. Do what you want. Stay in your hell or you can overcome it. Forgive your mother for setting you up like this. She couldn't help it. She hated your father. She hated God. She hated everything good. She could not help it. Satan was her daddy. Forgive her. She couldn't help herself. And forgive your father for not protecting you from her. He couldn't help himself.
All right.
And do the silent prayer. You know about the silent prayer?
Not really.
www.silentprayer.video on my YouTube channel. I want you to start doing it. Do your little hooping and hollering to Jesus. And when you're done hooping and hollering, you can go to rebuildingaman.com/prayer. And start doing that, all right?
Okay, sir.
All right, buddy. Back in a moment.
It is the best counseling service on this side of heaven. I counsel with men and women, families, individuals around the world. Most people are unhappy. They're miserable. They have rough lives. They're depressed, suicidal, young and old, of all races. I understand. I know why, and I do understand it. Because exactly what's happening in me is happening with everybody outside of me, inside of them. And I've noticed that with those who really, really, really want to understand, they overcome it just like that. Out of one counseling session. If you need counseling, you can go to rebuildingaman.com or call 800-411-2663. 800-411-BOND. Best counseling service on this side of heaven.
Idalia destroyed a lot, and insurers are pulling out of the Gulf states. Burning Man, the people who went to Burning Man are finally getting out, or finally got out of Burning Man after the flooding and mud and mess, and that one person died. And the China virus scare. The first lady, Dr. Jill Biden, caught the China virus, and they're pushing the vax, I think, right? And the and it's coming back or something. I don't know. And rest in peace to the Smash Mouth guy. He died because he drank way too much, I heard. This is the end of hour one of the Jesse Lee Peterson Show. It is Tuesday, September 5th, 2023 AD. Stay tuned for hour two. Jesse Lee will be right back to your calls, and Country and Western Tuesday will continue. There is one line open. You can call in to get on hold, to get on air with JLP. But first, fake news, not fake news. In the wake of Hurricane Idalia, which slammed into Florida last week, questions are being raised. I hate that. That's the passive voice. Questions are being raised about whether federal dollars should be allocated to rebuild repeatedly flooded infrastructure, communist buzzword. Meteorologists say that the Atlantic hurricane season hasn't peaked, and the Gulf of Mexico has been historically warm, meaning more energy to fuel more deadly storms. To make matters worse, many insurance companies are also pulling out of some Gulf states, leaving homeowners and businesses with more risk and fewer options to finance their recovery in a way that will leave buildings stronger and better able to withstand future hurricanes. Wow. Experts say that rebuilding homes to be elevated and more reinforced is an option, but that would be a major challenge without a healthy insurance market. That Burning Man mess, thousands of Burning Man attendees finally made their mass exodus Monday, yesterday, after an intense rain over the weekend flooded campsites. That's in Nevada, right? And trapped more than 70,000 festival goers in the makeshift Nevada city of Black Rock City or something like that. I don't know. Maybe Red Rock City? I don't know. Oh, yeah, Black Rock City. Organizers announced the driving ban that was imposed during heavy rains Friday has been lifted on Monday, and attendees could safely leave Black Rock City, the desert community erected every year for the event. Degenerate event, I hear, but I don't know, maybe a little bit artsy. The wait time to leave Monday night was roughly 7 hours, according to organizers. Drivers attempted to navigate the mud separately. Authorities confirmed a death at the festival on Saturday, unrelated to the weather, they say. So say the Burning Man organizers. First Lady Dr. Jill Biden, they don't call her doctor on CNN, tested positive for COVID-19, that's the Globo Homo name for the China virus, on Monday. She's experiencing mild symptoms, the Black on the Inside White House announced. So-called President Sleepy Joe Biden tested negative. Jill Biden's Dr. Jill's diagnosis comes amid renewed attention to the China virus as the world approaches the fourth virus season since the height of the scam epidemic. But new China virus variant BA.2.86, also known as Pirola, may be less contagious than feared. Lab tests show our immune systems can recognize and fight off this variant as well as, and perhaps even a lot better than, the current circulating offshoots of XBB variant. CDC data shows a slight increase in hospital admissions, emergency department visits, and positive China virus tests. Cases, but not nearly as high as past summers. Rest in peace, Smash Mouth guy. Steve Harwell, the founding lead singer of the rock group Smash Mouth, pop sort of rock, died on Monday. He was just 56 years old, the tender age of 56. Smash Mouth was best known for its singles All Star and I'm a Believer. What? What about Walking on the Sun? I don't know about I'm a Believer. I don't like that. That's a cover anyway. Which gained widespread popularity after its appearance in the soundtrack of the 2001 lame-o film Shrek. I'm James Hake. Now back to JLP. Hour 2.
Stand up strong, face the truth. about themselves to understand what went wrong. I know we can find a way. I know we can find a way. I know we can find a way.
Uniting the races with truth instead of dividing them with lies. We're also rebuilding the family by rebuilding the man. I am Jesse Lee Peterson. Welcome to the second hour of the show already. You can get involved. There is a line open at 888-773-773-888-77-JESSE. Brand new biblical question for this week. Brand new, and it is a doozy. It's a doozy. What is your state of mind? What is your state of mind? An amazing question. The one thing that I want to encourage you, that when you really, really get serious about overcoming the fallen state and start working on you, know thyself, there is no greater fun than working on yourself. When you first start out, it doesn't feel like fun, right? But as the light get brighter, the old nature starts to change, it will be fun. Stay with it, stay with it, stay with it. And you will see. You'll see. What the? We have every way that you can watch and support the show listed on jesseleepeterson.com/show. jesseleepeterson.com/show. And then if you're busy working out or doing whatever it is you're doing, you can listen to the show. And you can podcast as well, right? But if you want to listen while you're doing what you're doing, what you're doing, what you're doing, you can listen to the show on the listen line by calling calling with your cell phone or iPad. You can be listening. 641-793-1500. 641-793-1500. And don't forget to follow us on rumble.com/JesseLeePeterson and cozy.tv/JLP. Cozy.tv/JLP. Like, follow, ring the bell, subscribe. All right? And you can also, get your comments read out loud, you can donate and have your comments read out loud at buymeacoffee.com/JLP talk. buymeacoffee.com/JLP talk. And Bond JLP on Cash App. Jesse Lee Peterson on Cash App. Bond/Bond JLP. All right? It's Tuesday. It's the second hour of the show already. It is Country and Western Tuesday.
All my faults, well, they've all been lies. They let me down every single time, because the devil's been making holes inside my head. The good, the bad, the glad, the sad. If I could let them all go and give them to God, well, maybe He'd take this anger from my soul. And I'd shine like a light that's too bright to see. And I could lean on God, so He could lean on me. Forgive, forgiveness, righteous, perfect peace.
Amazing! Thank you, Pete, from Alaska. Amazing song. I appreciate it, man.
Amazing!
Alaska's beautiful, too. What's y'all? It's beautiful. a battle between good and evil, right versus wrong. I promise you, your battle is not with anyone, but it's with you, and you don't know it. Your battle is not with anyone else. Yes, there are people who have their own battles, but they try to take it out on you to make you be a part of their battle. But their battle is only with them too. It starts with you and it ends with you. All of your issues and all of your problems is with you, not anyone else on this side of heaven. And as long as you blame someone else for it, no matter what they try to do to you, as long as you blame them, you would never overcome the battle that's inside of you. If you want to overcome the battle of the world, meaning other people, you got to overcome the battle within yourself. There is a war going on in you, and you don't know it. And the war is a spiritual war. But there are demons outside of you, inside of others, trying to make you believe it's outside of you, and it's not. Yes, there are people trying to hurt you and treat you wrong and try to hurt you. That's because they haven't dealt with the battle inside of them, and they got to find somebody else to try to hurt so they can feel better about their battle. They want to keep it alive. It's not about racism, sexism, homophobiaism, Islamophobiaism, Debbie Dadism, Allahu Abba-ism, racism, white supremacism, or anti-Semitism. All those things are set up. It's all lies. It's none of those things, period. That's just to cover up evil so you can't see the battle that's going on inside of you. And if you see it in you, up here, and in here, the emotion, you're going to clearly see it in others, and you will not judge them no matter what they tried to do to hurt you. Because once you overcome the battle in you, no one can hurt you. They think they're doing it, but it's just a thought. All thoughts are all lies all the time about anything. Really. And they think that they're hurting you, and they're not. They're hurting themselves. They're not trying to help you. A person that tried to hurt you, they're trying to help you. And if not, why you pay them 1 ounce of any sense at all of your time? Amazing, huh? It's a spiritual battle. And every human being, why do you think you keep hearing about rumors of wars? The same war that the government is inflicted upon each other in different parts of the world, it's the same war you're dealing with and inflicting them on others in your world. You're at war with other people in your little world, in your environment. You're at war with your family, husband and wife, so-called friends, co-workers, near and far. It's the same thing. The same thing. But you could be free. You have paradise right here on earth. You can have paradise right here on earth. I want to show you an example of what hell looked like. It's just one small example of what hell looked like. But to this person, I'm sure it's a big example of what hell looked like. More and more drama of hell. And it's all around us now. It's everywhere. It's in the air. It's everywhere. It's in your bone. It's everywhere. Here's an example of what hell looked like and not heaven. This is from X. A girlfriend deleted her boyfriend's NBA 2K account. It's a video game. Because she wasn't getting enough attention from him. this is how he, this 2K thing is how he make a living. And she deleted it, according to this report. Watch this from X. A couple of things about that remind me of the Ultimatum movie that my producer, we talked about in the first hour. And then also, that woman, while she's standing there watching him scream and yell and go through it like that, and she's like, what's your deal? She is loving it. She is loving it and giving her, in her imagination, pure joy to inflict pain on him like that. And that's what happened with every human being that try to inflict pain on others. They feel the same way when they think that they can hurt you. That's why they do it. They need a false sense of life. And so they're not happy within themselves. They're miserable. They're dead and they know it spiritually. And so they go out roaming the earth to see who they can hurt. They turn on their own family members, friends or whatever, so they can feel alive. Him carrying on like that, she was loving it. It's just like in relationship with boyfriend, girlfriend, her husband and wife, when they fight one another and the other can get the other one to overreact, you're giving them life. They love it. They can go and have a good night's sleep now because you're suffering. And then this guy made the NBA 2K so important to him that he overreacted to it too. And she knew how important it was to him. That's why she went and did it, because she knew she was going to get a reaction from him. She's going to control him one way or another, and she did. It's evil. It's all evil. That's what's happening in you, and you do it to others. There was a caller last week who said, 18-year-old male, that his mother, when he went and forgave his mother, she had a hissy fit. And he was going to move, and she went and snatched the license plate off his car to keep him in there so she can flick hell on him. And he had to call the police on his mama, 18 years old. It's the same thing that's happening to you, folks. It's not you, but it's this thing that made a home in you. It's the same thing that made a home in you. You're not you. It's not you, those thoughts that make you shake and scared and overreact and freak out and bring out all this pain, that's the hell in you. You became like your mama. It was passed down to mama. And it repeats itself each generation. And in your mind, you keep thinking that the answer is in the mind. If I did it this way, if I did it that way, it'll be better. It's never going to get better. You hear the blacks, not all by a long shot now. Well, not by a long shot, but a lot of the blacks have started waking up. Most are not. But they keep crying racism, and the white man want to give them everything they cry for, and they only get worse because it's not the answer to their problem. They need to be born again of the Father. They need to forgive the mothers and return to their fathers by forgiving him, like every human being. And I was, if you notice, that setup right there was on camera. who set the camera up? So sometimes you think this whole thing may even be an act because it get them YouTube numbers or something like that, subscribers and things like that. I want to show you that one more time, and I want you to observe the cameras are set up perfectly. Now, I'm not saying it was staged, but I don't know nowadays. The cameras were set up perfectly, and they were acting out perfectly. This is from X. Watch this. See?
I'm done with you. I'm done.
No, seriously?
I'm done.
You're that?
Seriously? I'm done. I agree, man. Do you know how long I'm you don't understand. You don't understand. You always say this when it's always not funny. Stop touching my
look how she's loving it. Whether it's act or not, it's real. It's real. It's all evil. You're playing with the devil and don't know it. You're playing with the devil and blaming somebody else for it. If there's no you to be hurt, how can you be hurt? You're only being hurt because you think there's a you. You call the abnormal you, you. The fake personality, thoughts, and feelings, you. And that's why you could be hurt. Because you think it's you. What a mess! The whole world is like that. I was thinking about the other day, I was thinking, reflecting on how Joe Biden's wife, and his children allow Joe Biden to act as though he's the president and he knows what he's doing. And they're doing it for selfish reasons, for themselves. If Joe Biden truly loved Joe Biden, she would take him home and let him live the rest of his life out in a quiet way, doing whatever he needs to do. But it keep her out there. It keep so-called power and money for her. She doesn't love her husband. Period. If not, she wouldn't exploit him in that way, no matter who was telling her to do it. And it doesn't matter who they're trying to hurt with it, the Republicans or Democrats or whomever. They wouldn't hurt someone else if it wasn't about her. You don't realize you're dealing with evil and you give it all kind of fancy names to cover up the fact that it is evil. That first caller couldn't even admit or for himself that his sweetie mama was evil. He called her sweetie. And he blamed himself. I took advantage of it. She set him up by spoiling him. He took advantage of being spoiled because that's all he knew. He was made to be that way. And he blamed himself instead of sweetie mama. And then he mad at daddy because daddy was a sweetie. What a mess. When will you wake up? If not now, when? And if you thought that was evil with the boy screaming over this woman allegedly deleted all his stuff there on his video game. And it may have happened. If you thought that was evil, the New York Post is reporting a Florida mother, they say mom. Everybody say mom. Mom sounds so special. Did you know when I was growing up, it was called mother? Not mom. Mom just sounds so loving and warm and fuzzy. When mother used to be fine. A daddy. This is from the New York Post. A Florida mom I say mother, but they say mom, says she fatally choked 13-year-old son. According to the court records, Jasmine Kennedy called herself Yahweh. Who is Yahweh?
I think it's a term for God.
Called herself Yahweh and allegedly told deputies that she spared her son from the devil. So the devil is spared her son from the devil by, according to this report, choking him. Watch this from Fox.
Osceola County, a child found dead this morning in St. Cloud.
The sheriff gave an update a little more than an hour ago on the case.
The Osceola County sheriff says this mother killed her teenage son, and now investigators are trying to figure out why. Take a look at this crime scene. Now, deputies say they were dispatched to Crossley Avenue in St. Cloud at around 7:30 this morning and discovered the 13-year-old boy laying face up in bed, dead. They say 37-year-old Jasmine Kennedy, the mother of the teenager, told them she choked her son. Listen to what Sheriff Marcos Lopez had to say.
She basically is admitting to doing it. And, like I said, those are some of the things that we're going to work out now. And we're still interviewing her, and this investigation unfolds.
Kennedy will be charged with domestic battery by strangulation, as well as child neglect and aggravated abuse.
Amazing. Yahweh told her to do it. Is it Yahweh? Yahweh told her to do it. So just think about that. The devil told her to do it. If the story's true, the devil told her to do it. But he told her, this is God telling you to do it. This is God telling you to do it. It's the same devil that's telling you to go down to the front of the church and accept Jesus. And now you know Jesus. And then for the rest of your life, until you wake up to it, and most people don't, oh, they think they hear from Jesus. I heard this voice in my head, and that voice in my head told me to go feed the hunger. That voice and that voice was Jesus. And yet you're miserable. That's the same voice that told this person to choke her son. Fatally. All in the name of Jesus. And if you think that's bad, it's interesting how evil is having its way. It's having its way. And every human being suffers from it, but most will not pause to see what it is. Isn't that like amazing? Another example of evil. This is from Court TV. Court-TV. A Florida man is facing a list of charges after allegedly injecting chemicals into his neighbor's apartment. Watch this from Inside Edition.
You are watching what cops say is a terrible crime committed by a brilliant chemist. First, he's seen filling a syringe with some sort of substance. Then he places the syringe under an apartment door. Umar Abdullah and his wife had just had a baby. Almost immediately, they say, their downstairs neighbor, then a PhD student in chemistry, began complaining about noise. That's him skulking outside the apartment in Tampa.
After my daughter was born, right after we came back from hospital, he started complaining.
Then the family began smelling chemicals pervading the apartment. Everyone, including the baby, started getting sick.
She used to cough and subsequently she used to vomit.
Air conditioning ducts were cleaned. Plumbers checked all the pipes leading to the apartment, and the landlord even replaced the water heater. But the noxious fumes became overwhelming. And that's when the new dad decided to install a hidden camera. At first, the surveillance video caught just a glimpse of the suspect. The next day, when the camera was repositioned, this happened, and the terrifying truth came out. Initial toxicology reports from police say the substance being pumped into their apartment consists of two strong opioids, methadone and hydrocodone. The suspect is identified as Xu Ming Li, who got his PhD in chemistry at the University of South Florida. A promising future ahead of him, now in jeopardy for one incredibly foolish act.
Amazing. See, the more PhDs you get, the dumber you become. Evil. Isn't that amazing? He's like, y'all gonna make this baby shut up or else. Oh, you gonna make the baby shut up. What the? So the same devil that told that man to go do that, allegedly do that, it's the same devil that told this woman to choke her baby and say that Yahweh said it. It's the same thing. Yeshua or whatever said it. It's the same spirit. The same spirit that made these people do this, it's the same spirit that caused fear inside of you. Jealousy and envy and strife and worrying and anger. It's the same spirit. Our battle is a spiritual battle. Either you overcome that spirit or you live it in it, and it will destroy you. It makes you try to destroy others. Amazing. 888-775-3773. Let me go to Dwayne out of South Carolina. Dwayne, welcome to the show. You're on the air. Hey, Dwayne. Dwayne going once. Dwayne going twice. Hold on, Dwayne. You've been waiting a long time. You might have your thing on. Super chat. Super.
Super chat.
Super chats.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you? Good morning, Super Chatters.
Yes, good morning, Super Chatters.
Good morning to me.
Good morning, Hank.
Hey.
Hey.
With the Henley.
What's the Henley?
Henley shirt.
Oh, is that the style that it is?
Yeah.
Because it has these buttons and no collar?
Yeah.
Cool.
Amazing.
Someone bought 5 coffees. Jesse Lee, Hake, Hassan, Sean, anchor emoji, baby emoji, anchor baby. Thank you for your consistent message in a world that knows and always has known darkness, chaos, and a mess. God's love and light shows through you all, says someone.
Thank you. Thank you for your support. And also, cut out the fight. Stop fighting with people. It's just devils fighting devils. Thank you very much.
Mike Young bought a coffee. Hey, Jesse, why did God choose Israel?
I don't know. Because there were no other Jews around. I don't know, Mike. Good question.
Why did God choose Abraham? Well, anyway, nice. Thank you, Mike Young. Interesting question.
Thank you, Mike. Yeah.
And that was from yesterday. And thanks to the top contributors on DLive yesterday. Diane D, not Dylan D. Evgeny Crosby, Games for Rec. And lunch.
From what? D-Live?
Yeah, D-Live, okay. Top contributors. Okay. And Noah's Ark, Kansas, appreciate you guys. Chillin' Lean bought a coffee. Jesse, what is your take on the song Imagine by John Lennon?
Who asked that?
Chillin' Lean with his coffee.
What is my opinion about that song?
Yeah, Imagine.
Let me hear it.
Imagine no religion. Something, something, something. I know you can do it. We can try if we can. Help me out, Hassan.
I'm looking
over at Hassan smirking.
Right now, I can't think of that song. It sounds familiar, though. But when I can hear it, then I may have a comment on it. Thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Mr. Pink bought a coffee. But
James just tried to present it. I still don't know.
Yeah, I failed.
Oh, imagine there were no people.
Yeah.
All the grass in the world.
Yep.
Ooh. That's it?
Yes, sir.
Let me take a break. We'll finish Super Chat when we come back. And your phone calls. 888-77-JESSE. Quick break. Back in a moment. Now, I totally disagree with the way things are going, but you can't be angry because that's what the enemy wants. He wants to control you. They do things to make you mad so they can control you. It's like being married. And the wife would do things to make you mad, or she would do things to make you feel good. And men do that to women, too, when they want something from the woman, especially sex. They'll make her feel good, or they'll make her angry. And the woman's gonna have to say, you don't want to be angry. You want to speak up. You want to disagree with what's going on. It's wrong, but do not be angry. Then you won't have fear. You won't have doubt. You won't have worries. You'll be able to see, but you got to stay away from anger. That's why you must forgive your mothers and your fathers so that you can overcome the spirit of anger. It's a spirit and it's wicked. Nothing good in anger because it has no love, folks. You need love to defeat evil. And love is not a weakness. It's a strength. It's from God. It's His nature. Okay, welcome back. I was reflecting on that Japanese guy that was putting that poison under the door, allegedly, of those family there. What the? Ship him back to his country fast.
What the?
Can you imagine? Grandpa, tell me about the good old days. I never would imagine that. Okay, the baby won't be quiet. They have a baby there. That baby crying. I tell them to tell the baby to be quiet. They were, I'm going to put some poison under the door. That doesn't even make sense. Anyway, the Hake Report is coming up at 9 a.m. The Hake, H-A-K-E, report.com from 9 to 11. The guy with the good hair. And then at 11 a.m. is Tuesday, Joel Friday TV every Tuesday. Joel Friday every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Pacific time. He did a special yesterday because it was a socialist holiday. So he came in and did a special on that. You could podcast. And at 12 noon, the American Anchor Baby. The American Anchor Baby at 12 noon. Right after Joel Friday TV. And they are both on fire. Tomorrow, wow. It's at 11 a.m. Her son, new show, wow, walking on water. He and his dog talking about who let the dogs out, huh? And so wow is tomorrow at 11 a.m. If you need counseling, we have the best counseling service on this side of heaven by phone, Skype, or walk-in. Go to rebuildingtheman.com, rebuildingtheman.com. Or call 800-411-BOND, 800-411-2663. You can make donations there and everything, all right? The men's forum this Thursday night at 7 p.m. Pacific time. Every first Thursday night for men only. Third is for ladies. And Sunday morning for everybody. Let's finish up those super chats we started on. Super, super. There is two lines open if you want to jump in there. 888-77.
Coffee, it's Country and Western Tuesday. Yeehaw.
Country and Western Tuesday. Thank you.
Shout out to the late, great Jimmy Buffett. Lots of nice little songs about letting go and letting life happen. I still remember seeing him as my first concert when I was 10 with my dad. Now Jimmy can truly have his cheeseburger in paradise.
Nice. Amazing. Thank you. So I listened to a bit of that song.
Imagine.
Imagine.
Not by Jimmy Buffett.
No, not by Jimmy Buffett.
By John Legend. Lennon.
John Lennon.
Yeah.
And I remember that song now. Imagine all the people living in a world. Imagine there was no hell. Imagine there was no heaven. And I liked the song, but at the time I wasn't, when I first started hearing it as a kid or younger, I wasn't thinking about what it meant. But I do remember him saying, imagine there was no hell or heaven. And the one thing I can say, overcome the imagination, it will be paradise on earth. I don't know if he meant that, but if you get over the imagination, you could be free. You can be free. Amazing. Thank you.
Mike Young bought a coffee. Hey, Jesse, what do you think this lovely black-sounding name like Takaya Young that was pregnant and was stealing liquor, allegedly, at a grocery store, and the cops were called, and of course she resisted, allegedly, and tried to run over a cop, allegedly, with her car, and then the cops shot and killed her. But of course that don't seem to matter, but to the race hustlers and the protesters, what a mess, he says.
I don't know about that story, Mike.
American Anchor Baby covered it.
Oh, I'm not familiar, so I can't comment on it. Thank you, though.
All right.
Amazing.
Sounds kind of typical to me. I'm not that familiar either, though. Someone bought a coffee. Hey, hi, Jesse. I am trying to do the silent prayer, but every time I see some evil images and I have this voice in my mind, a feeling telling me to stop. I tried to keep going, but I feel like I felt like a panic attack. Should I keep trying?
Do what you want, but I would recommend you do, because you're going to see that the thoughts and feelings that you're getting is not you. They're not you. You think that they're you, and it wants you to stop because it doesn't want the light to shine on it. So it's trembling, and the truth is trying to catch it with you, the light, to destroy that. So you would no longer have to deal with it. I recommend you do, but it's up to you. Thank you.
Stan60Nan donated a Ninjagini on DLive. Hi, Jesse. I mean, hi, JLP. That's a pack mule that you had earlier this last hour. I don't know where you guys put it. You banished the pack mule.
We sent the mule packing.
Y'all never used mules down south? Y'all never hauled firewood on a mule? He asks.
No. We use a wagon.
Now we use Ninjaginis.
We used a wagon for mules. I never used no, you know. I do know they did that in Mexico, according to the cowboy movies and things like that. But down in Alabama, we had a wagon, and the mules were pulling the wagon.
Sweet.
Thank you.
Another diamond from Games for Rec. I have a receptive. Oh, this is his answer to the biblical question.
Okay. What is your state of mind?
I have a receptive state of mind. Good question, he says.
What's a receptive state of mind?
It receives. He receives.
Oh, okay. Hey, I'll put my two cents in on Sunday. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Evil is real, bought a coffee. I saw this guy in a wheelchair. He was drooling all over himself. Pretty sure he was a flat earther. Had a mama wiping his face. Made me want to shout out to all the chat people. You sitting there in the chat thinking you're smart, but are actually super R-worded. Shout out to you, he says.
Thank you.
Eric Bergman bought a coffee. Eric Bergman says, hello, Jesse. What kind of music do you listen to in your spare time? Country? Rap? Or maybe even some heavy metal? Peace and love from Sweden, he says.
Nice. In all honesty, I don't listen to a lot of music now. But when I do, I listen to what do you call the music I like?
Pop.
And sometimes a little country too, but pop music. Thank you.
Adele.
I haven't listened to her in a long time either. Is she pop music?
Yeah, I would say so.
I listen to pop music.
Kelly Clarkson.
Justin Bieber.
Yeah, Justin Bieber. I didn't know that that was Justin Bieber. My mama don't like you.
Oh, yeah.
I just found out that that was Justin Bieber.
Yeah, it's Justin. My mama don't like you. She likes everyone.
But written by a very talented black man.
Nice.
Oh, he had to call him very talented because he's black. He had to add it to it to make sure they know.
That goes without saying, man.
He had to make sure they know he's not racist against the black.
So I was just saying because Haik was like, well, I didn't even know that was Justin Bieber because I think it sounds black, the song.
Does it?
It sounds like soulful.
Yeah, I thought it was either like Train or one of those people.
Yeah.
I don't know if Train is the right one, but it's somebody else. Anyway.
I like that song. Once I was 7 years old, my mama told me, boy, you better get married and you're going to be lonely. Something like that.
With Lucas Graham,
that's
I think.
Pop, right?
Amazing
yeah.
song.
Yeah. You like that song?
Great song. Incredible.
Yeah. Amazing. Thank you.
Someone bought a coffee. Superior Dave is Jesse's favorite listener and is by far the most alpha male he's ever seen.
Who's that?
Someone. Superior Dave. Not to be confused with Super Dave. This is a boomer.
He said, who is my favorite?
Superior Dave is your favorite listener. By far the most alpha male you've ever seen.
Thank you, Superior Dave. Amazing.
But someone is the person who bought the coffee.
Nice.
Maybe it is Superior Dave. And thank you, guys. That's all for now. Oh, no. Evil is still real. Evil is real. Bought a coffee. Every single time a cop shoots a person, I say, job well done, sir. If it is a female cop, though, I say, go home and make babies.
Amazing. That's right.
I censor his super chats sometimes.
What
so,
the?
FYI.
Nice.
I don't know if I'm doing it. I'm trying to do it justice, but keep it clean enough. Protect the channel. Nice. All right, thank you guys. That's all for now.
Thank you all. I do appreciate it. Let me go to the phones. There's one line open now. 888-775-3773. 888-77-JESSE. Let me go to first time call out of Michigan, Riard. Riard, welcome to the show. You're on the air.
Hello, Jesse. How are you?
All is well.
Yeah, I call you Black Rush Limbo.
He black.
I'm actually Chaldean. I want to introduce my nationality to you here in Michigan.
Right on.
I don't know if you're familiar with Chaldeans. It's a huge population here in Michigan.
Oh, crazy.
Yeah, we're ancient people. So I'm always sharing you with my Facebook. You're probably getting more and more people looking at you because what I share with my Facebook.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Absolutely, because you brought my attention like about 3 years ago where I was looking things in Facebook regarding like Ben Shapiro, Matt Walsh, and things like that. And then you start coming in with the interview by one-on-one with other people. You know, they have those two chairs separated and you kind of flip them out and you say things like, these black people are like, what the heck this guy saying to me, you know? And it just threw them out.
That's the fallenstate.tv.
Yeah, yeah. And so the more I got into it, then I started realizing you have a live shows. And now I watch you every day. Everything you say is what I've seen in my life here. You know, I came in 1973 as a child from, Chaldeans are from Iraq. From the Ur of the Chaldean, you are. We're in the Bible. We're mentioned over 80 times in the Bible. Abraham was Chaldean. I don't know if you know that. God in Genesis told him, leave the city of the Ur to the promised land.
So you're a Christian?
So I'm Roman Catholic, yes. I'm an Eastern Rite Roman Catholic.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So, definitely, and I actually got invited a few times in a radio station where I'm able to speak about a certain topic like the Mary and things like that. I wanted to mention, I know a couple of questions came in as biblical and says that...
What is your state of mind?
No, it was a biblical question. Somebody texted about why did the it's called Israel and why did he choose Abraham?
Oh, okay, yeah.
They
want to know why did God choose Abraham. Do you know why?
Well, yeah. I mean, first of all, people need to realize, Abraham actually was more like Donald Trump at that time. He was very rich. He had, 10,000 camels or servants or, he was very rich. So when people say they're rich people, they're evil. No, he was actually one of the holiest person that God chosen him. Just like St. Paul said, the love of money is the root of all evil. Not because you have money, it's the love of money. But Abraham was very, he's been blessed by God, but yet he was very obedient to God.
And why did God choose him?
Well, he chose him because he was extremely holy, but he was in the Ur of the Chaldeans. He was Chaldean, and he was not Jewish. He's not, there was no Israel even mentioned even prior to that. But he was very holy. He even tested him several times, and he used him as an example, and he took him through a survey. So when he went and took him out to the land of Israel, he knew that spot of Middle East, it's not going to stay the way it is. As you can see, that in Iraq is nothing but troubles over there. Constantly.
So, let me do this because of time. So,
yes.
Abraham was chosen by God because he was very holy, right?
Yes, but also he wants it, to make sure his son comes from this family.
Abraham, wasn't he the grandfather of Israel?
Not yet. Israel has not mentioned yet. This is what I was getting at. When Isaac came in, again, he was still Chaldean. When Jacob came in, he was still Chaldean until he wrestled with the angel, and I believe it was in Genesis 32:28, and that's when I believe that the angel called that spot wrestling with God.
Let me do this because I'm black and slow, and you say a lot, but I don't quite understand, and time is running out right here. So Abraham was the father of Isaac and the grandfather of Jacob, right?
Right, because
Jacob was of Israel, right?
He stole a blessing from his older brother.
Give me a yes or no, then I'll let you add a little bit to it, all right?
Okay, sure.
So Abraham was the father of Isaac.
Yes, he was the father of Isaac, sir.
And grandfather of Jacob.
Exactly. Yaqub. The real name is Yaqub.
And Israel, was Jacob Israel?
Jacob is Israel, yes, sir.
And Israel wrestled with the angel. Is that right?
Exactly. 32:28. You can look it up. Genesis 32:28.
And that's when they changed Jacob's name to Israel?
Yes. Because he demanded to be blessed. He didn't want him to go back to heaven, and he wanted his blessing because he didn't feel like he has all the blessing because he knew he deceived his father. And all, again, because of a woman, the mother, she used his father. Her son, younger son, she chose him to deceive her her older son. She wanted the blessing to go to the younger son, and that's not appropriate in the Judaism back then. The blessing had to go to the older son.
Amazing.
So he deceived him. He dressed like his father because Isaac was blind, was going blind. And one of the key things Jesse, is that whenever they approached God after all these three children was taken place, always in the Judaism you could hear they say, we are the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Notice they always say that. They used to say that to Jesus all the time. We are children of Abraham. This was very important to remember that, the reason why he wanted Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to go on. And the reason why is because that's where the 12 tribes of Israel started after Jacob.
Amazing. But let me do that. I can't. This is, we do this kind of Bible Thumper Thursday. when we have a little bit more time. Are you able to call me on Bible Slump Thursday, and I'll give you a little bit more time, but we just don't have it today.
Let me ask, I
thought you were calling in about today's biblical question. What is your state of mind?
Biblical question?
Yeah, for you. What is your state of mind? That's the biblical question for this week.
Okay, I see. Well, when you say state of mind, I mean, you're saying, are you all together or what?
What is your state of mind?
My state of mind, I believe what I understand the question is that I need to make sure that, I have to know what's going on, be alerted all the time of what's going on, to know what, just like St. Paul said, he says, keep an armor on you at all times, for there's a war against flesh and blood. He didn't say, armor mean like to fight, but to be knowledgeable. We got to wake up. We got to know what's going on. We can't just, have the devil continue to throw stuff at us.
So in short, your state of mind is what?
My state of mind is... well alert.
All right. Amazing. Thank you for responding.
You're amazing.
Call me on, if you can, call back on Bible Thumper anytime you want, but Bible Thumper Thursday too, all right?
I have a lot of information I could tell you if you ever wanted to call me privately. Okay. There's a lot of information you need to know that you could help and introduce it to your show.
Right on.
You know?
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, buddy. I appreciate
you.
God
bless.
All right. Okay. 888-775-3773. Let me go to a first-time call out of Kentucky. Colt. Welcome to the show. You're on the air.
Thank you, Jesse. How you doing today?
All is well, sir.
Perfect. Hey, man, I just wanted to call and thank you and just let you know that, I, among many other people, appreciate you, your inspiration, your wisdom. It's been really good for me here lately, and I can even touch on that with the biblical question of the week.
What is your state of mind?
Yeah, I would say focused and determined. I would say that's pretty accurate.
Focus on what and determined to do what?
I would say focused mainly on my goals. I've had a few short-term goals here lately. During COVID and all that, when we were dealing with all that, I was dealing with some serious anxiety, panic attacks, things like that, things that I had... I used to make fun of people, my close friends, I would say, they would be having anxiety or panic or whatever. And I would be like, oh, suck it up. It doesn't exist. It's in your head, blah, blah, blah. So I got my revenge, or karma got its revenge on me there. So I was going through all that anyway. To make a long story short, I've just been making some short-term goals to kind of progress in my life. I work for the federal government. I'm a full-time employee with the federal government. I do IT data center operations.
But how would that cause you to progress in life?
Well, so focusing, and setting these short-term goals, I think, takes your mind, away from all the evils of the world.
Are you able to hold for me, Colt?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, hold on, buddy. I got to take a quick break. One more hour to go. There is a line open at 888-775-3773. Back in a moment. As the world moves on, time sings a song. You can't run from evil within yourself or outside of self. You got to deal with it. And you need good in order to deal with evil. And God is good. You need to return to the Father. And you'll see within you, he will fight the battle for you. And he will fight it without, because he will show you how to deal with it. And you will have no fear. Love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your might, along with nothing else. Nothing else means yourself, your children, your wife, your things, your ego, your reputation, and all that. You can't care about any of that. the children of anger will use it to control you. But if you love God, he will renew your mind, and none of those things will be before him. And so when they go after you, oh, well, you may take my body, you may take my things, but you're not going to take my soul. And that's a true reality.
War enablement. It's been 19 months of Ukraine and Russia at war and Globo Homo with the help of Globo Homo. What a mess. And that Maui wildfire investigation, 385 people still unaccounted for after the deadly fires in Maui, Hawaii, down from a peak of about 1,200. But it's not that far down because it was like 400 something, roughly 400. It feels like a week or two ago, and it's still at 385. And based North Korea, I say that loosely, facetiously, I guess, but they're involved with Russia some way. This is the end of hour two of the Jesse Lee Peterson Show. It's Country and Western Tuesday, September 5th, 2023 AD. JLP will be right back for hour three, guys. The lines are full. He will be right back to your calls and more great stories. But first, Hake News, not fake news. After the Jesse Lee Peterson Show, the Hake Report, as you all know. And if you, some of you guys tune in, I appreciate it. And of course, after Hake, I definitely recommend you check out Joel Friday TV. He had a special stream yesterday, Monday, so-called Labor Day, communist holiday, so-called holiday, Satan Day. But he was here. That was cool. And he's back again today. Nice. Tomorrow's going to be Wow Hassan, Walking on Water Hassan. And of course, at noon Pacific time, American Anchor, baby. Always cool. I caught the stream after the stream yesterday. Part of it at the beginning. Very cool stream. Very informative and insightful. Anyway, war enablement. 19 months of Russia and Ukraine have been at war as the conflict drags on because Globo Homo is enabling Ukraine to keep fighting, keep up the killing. Ukrainian unchristian President Volodymyr Zelensky is making personnel changes, citing the need for new approaches to ramp up the country's counteroffensive and to root out corruption in the Ukrainian government. I don't know. Maybe he should start with himself. He's not a Christian, you know. He is by nature corrupt. Or am I wrong? Maybe I'm wrong. At least 385 people still unaccounted for following the deadly fires in Maui, per Commie Nonsense Network, CNN, down from a peak of about 1,200. It's not down from a peak of 1,200. It's down from 400 last week or 2 weeks ago. Hawaii Governor Josh Green, probably not a Republican, urged people to file missing persons reports as island authorities face mounting scrutiny over whether more action could have been taken. There's whether they could have taken more action. They're using the passive voice to warn residents about the flames in Lahaina, which I have pronounced Lahaina before, which killed 115 people at least, right, and counting. Meanwhile, Hawaii Tourism Authority is hoping to rebuild quickly travel demand amid a drop in revenue. Ihia Gionson. A spokesman for the Hawaii Tourism Authority told CNN people should stay away from West Maui burn areas, but the rest of the island and other Hawaiian islands are open for business. Maybe tickets are cheap right now. Maybe. Don't know. He said people may not want to intrude, but when the economy is all about tourism, the last thing you want is economic downturn to follow the disaster. So take advantage. Head on over there. Show your support. Or save your money. Might be worth saving your money, right? Might be heading for hard times. Based North Korea. They're unchristian, though. And I'm saying it facetiously again. I don't know. North Korean so-called leader Kim Jong-un, the fat little rocket man, may travel to Russia to meet President Vladimir Putin for discussions on a potential deal to supply Moscow with weapons for its war in Ukraine. Oh, so he's enabling Russia for the war, kind of like Globo Homo is enabling Ukraine for their war. So evil, continuing the killing. According to U.S. government, Kim's possible visit to Russia comes as the U.S. has expressed increasing concerns about North Korea's military assistance to Russia's war effort in Ukraine, a move that would be a breach of U.S. sanctions. When asked for a comment on the matter, the Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov said today, "We have nothing to say on the subject. Apart from North Korea, Russia will also have to receive drones from artillery from Iran." I'm James Hake. Now back to JLP, Hour 3.
Uniting the races with truth instead of dividing them with lies. We're also rebuilding the family by rebuilding the man. I am Jesse Lee Peterson. Welcome to the third hour of the show already. There is one line open. You can get involved by calling 888-77-5373. 888-77-JESSE. J-E-S-S-E. My biblical question for this week, a brand new doozy. What is your state of mind? What is your state of mind? Isn't that an amazing question? What is your state of mind? We have every way that you can watch and support the show listed on jesseleepeterson.com/show. jesseleepeterson.com/show. And if you're out and about busy today, doing what it is that you're doing anywhere in the world, we're heard around the world. And for the flat earthers up and down the world, Monday through Friday, right? So if you're busy, can't watch the show, you can podcast, but you can listen online by on your iPhone or iPad by calling the listen line at 641-793-1500, 641-793-1500. And don't forget to follow us, JLP Talk on Twitter, JLP Talk on Twitter, Jesse Lee Peterson on Instagram, cozy.tv, cozy.tv/JLP, and JLP Talk on Twitter. All right, so it's Tuesday, the last hour of the show. It is Country and Western Tuesday.
And it is the saga of 13 separate colonies that united to form the most just and virtuous republic ever conceived. On this day, 243 years ago, our founding fathers pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor to declare independence and defend our God-given rights.
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
If you notice, yeah, Eli just feels white.
Yeah. Amazing. Barbara Thumper. Country and Western Tuesday. I want to finish up the call with Colt. Oh, Colt is gone?
Yeah, he's gone.
Oh, okay. I was on a call with Colt. He was responding to the biblical question, first time caller, but he's gone right now. Colt, you can call back if you like. 888-7753-773. I have with me Bill Lockwood, and we're going to get to him in a moment. Let me know when you guys are ready, all right? They're setting up now. In the meantime, let me just get to some. Hold on a minute. Let me type a note. Let me get to Brandy. No, I'm sorry, Brian, and then Brandy. Brian, a first-time caller out of New York. Brian, welcome to the show. You're on the air.
How you doing, Mr. Jesse Lee Peterson?
All is well, sir. Thanks for calling.
Hey, listen, you do an amazing job. I never heard anybody say forgive your mother and forgive your father until I had to realize that when my child's mother, me and her, went through our stuff, my mother sided with them, sided with her, and made my life a living hell trying to see my daughter again. And now we starting to get a good relationship with my daughter, but it's still hard. These women are wicked. I swear, man.
Yeah, and they can't help it. That's why we have to, it's the man's job to overcome mama so he can show the woman how to overcome the hell that's in her.
And how can we overcome that?
By forgiving your mother for imposing her will on you as a child and turning you away from her, your father, making you angry and all that. When you forgive her, meaning that you realize she can't help what she did, just like you can't help the feelings and thoughts you're having. When you realize the thoughts. Yeah,
because the thoughts, how I be feeling like that, Jesse. Yeah, you're not lying. Because, like, my child mother, she started to say, I try to rape my daughter. And that was crazy.
Yeah.
And that was crazy. And then all of a sudden, my sister, my grandmother, all of them turned their back against me. It was amazing, man.
That's what they do. They lie on you, and then people take sides like that. And they have no business even being a part of it at all.
That's the devil.
Yeah, it is. But they'll take sides. But you got to forgive your mother for what she's done, and God will forgive you. And then be done with her. Have nothing else to do with her.
Nothing else.
Just so be
and live
angry.
All my life.
Yeah, go live your life. Be done with her. Because unless you overcome that hell that's in her, and that was passed down to her from her mother, she will destroy you.
Wow. And preachers don't talk like this. Preachers, they don't talk like this. Like, I've been in church, but it was something that, like, I don't know. It wasn't real to me. I just see women have Holy Ghost up and down the church, and I was like, I don't hear the word.
Yeah. Amazing.
Amazing, Jesse.
And so it's still, do you still see your daughter or no?
No, my daughter now, she's like got a mindset of her mom, seems like.
How old is she?
So she's 15.
Yeah, she has a mother mindset. Her mother has done to her exactly what your mother did to you.
Gave me fear and anger?
Yep, absolutely. And they have turned your daughter away from you toward the hell that's in them, which is of the devil.
Wow. So
now you see what your father was dealing with your mother. That's why he wasn't able to protect you from your mother. He didn't understand the hell that was in her.
Wow. And it's funny you say that, because my father always to say, oh, you don't understand, Brian. When you get older, you have kids, you understand. I was like, what is he talking about? And I was real young, and he used to say that.
Yeah.
But this is amazing, Jesse. I'm so happy you keep doing this, man. Jesse, man, you're the best, man. I swear, I listen to you every day, brother. Keep doing what you're doing, brother.
Have you gone and forgiven your mother yet?
No. I don't even know how, like, I don't even know what kind of words I should put together.
Mother, I'm sorry for hating you. I realize now you can help yourself. I'm sorry for hating you. And if she apologizes, fine. If she doesn't, fine. If she start crying, fine. If she start blaming others, fine. If she fall out and die, fine. You go live your life. Don't ask for forgiveness. God said that when we forgive others, he will forgive us because they don't know what they're doing. Your mother can't see what she's doing. She love her hell more than she love heaven.
Wow. So that's what I mean of being blind.
Yes. 100%.
Nice. Wow.
And your grandmother and your other family members who have joined forces with your mother against you, they can't help it either. They cannot see.
But the thing is, to me, is they joined forces against me, but they hate each other.
Yes. That's why they joined forces.
It's amazing.
Brian, that's why they join forces, because the devil always joins forces with others to try to destroy others, because the devil cannot stand alone.
Really? Wow. Yeah. Man, yo, this is crazy. And people don't talk like this. Like, and like when I first heard you speak, Jesse, I swear, I was like, that's it right there. That's the truth right there.
And you know what?
I've been yearning for.
You've been yearning for it, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I've been yearning for the truth for a long time, Mr. Jesse.
That's why you recognize it when you hear it, because it's God. God knows your heart, and he knows that you want the truth. And so it was him that allowed you to see where I was coming from. He is with you. And that voice that allowed you to see the truth is the voice of God, not the voice in your head, but the voice, the voiceless voice. The one that allowed you to recognize that what Jesse is saying is true. That's the voice of God. He's with you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Jessica. I don't want to be a beta no more, Jesse. I'm tired of being a beta. I'm tired of being a beta.
So,
but thank you so much, Mr. Jesse.
Are you doing the silent prayer yet?
No, I don't know how to do that, Mr. Jesse.
I want you to go to rebuildingtheman.com.
Hold on. Rebuildingtheman.com?
Yeah, /prayer. Isn't that right? /prayer. Rebuildingtheman.com/prayer. And I want you to start doing that so God can bring you out of the darkness of the thought, the imagination, and he would, which is of the devil, which came from your mama, by the way. And he will set you free from that and make you free. And it's going to be amazing for you.
Wow. So your thoughts is not real.
All thoughts are all, except for practical thought. You know, you got to go to work, you got to eat, you need a car to get you to work. But other than that, all thoughts are all lies all the time.
Oh, man. This is amazing, Jesse. Oh, man. Like I said, I'm mind blown, Jesse. Every day I keep watching, watch your show. It's amazing.
Well, let me know what you think about the prayer, all right?
I definitely will. I will work on that. You said morning and night.
Morning and night. And then during the day, practice keeping your mind where your body is. Your body is in the present. It's right here, right now, but your mind will be thinking about the past or the so-called future, which doesn't exist.
Wow. Thank you so much, Mr. Jesse.
You're welcome,
And man. I will call you back, brother.
Okay. And as far as those people who have turned on you, wish them well, but stay away from them.
Oh, I do. I do. I learned that now because, like I said, they ain't do me harm, I can say. They just put stuff in my imagination that made me think I was that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now I understand, get out your thoughts, and, oh, man, this is amazing.
I wish you were, Brian.
Thank you so much, Mr. Jesse. I will call again.
Okay, let me know how the prayer go, too, all right?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
All right, buddy. It's the same thing everywhere. Everywhere. Is Bill ready? Not yet. Oh, okay. It's the same thing everywhere. It's a spiritual battle. Let me go to Brandy out of Hawaii, then the next caller. There's one line open at 888-777-5773. Brandy, welcome to the show. You're on the air.
Good morning, Jesse.
Good morning. How are you?
Good. I just figured I'm up early, so I'd call you and overcome my fear.
No, only God is good.
I'm amazing.
Amazing. That's right.
I'm up early, so I figure I'd call you and overcome my fears.
Nice.
You know, like we were talking last week, how I'm a chicken. You know, last week I was having a hard time talking to you because everybody's listening. So I figured maybe I should start calling every once in a while and overcome it.
That's right. You got to face the fear within yourself.
Yes, face it. Remember last week, I think it was last week or the week before, I called you about applying at the school and we talked about the Maui fires a little bit.
Oh, yeah. Never ask a black man if he remembers.
I'm bringing back that memory.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah, I just figured I'd call you and talk to you a little bit more about, I guess, the fires. And I have not heard from the school yet. I was wondering how long I should wait before I decide to bug them.
How long has it been?
It's been like 2 weeks.
And what would happen if you gave a follow-up call? I'm just checking to find out.
Probably nothing.
Yeah, give them a call.
Yeah, give them a call.
Yeah, just say, hey, I'm doing a follow-up on my application. They haven't hired you yet, right?
No, I haven't heard back yet.
Yeah.
They're probably looking at my Facebook, and they're like, oh, we can't trust her. She's a Trump supporter.
How do they know about your Facebook?
I don't know. I'm partly joking, but I hear that some jobs look that up.
Don't listen to those thoughts at all.
No.
And just because it happened to 1,000 people, that doesn't mean it's going to happen to you. But if you believe it when the devil tell you that, and you start to have the fear, then you're bringing that upon yourself. The fear will bring it upon you.
Yeah.
You trust your husband?
Yeah, I trust him.
But what?
What do you mean?
So when he was giving you the same advice I gave you, why did you take his advice?
It was like my idea to start. Well, the reason I decided to go to the school is because of you. I was doing a silent prayer on the way to work one day, and you know, like I think you were talking about that day, talking about moms need to stay at home and stuff. And I was like trying to figure out, well, how, if I can't stay at home, what's the best next thing? And I started thinking, like, maybe it's a good thing for parents if they can't stay at home. Maybe the moms need to go back to school. You know, like back in the day, even when I was a kid, a lot of the moms would volunteer. They were involved more in school. And maybe that's the problem, is that parents need to. And I know out here we're a small community, so I know that they do hire parents a lot more and promote that.
Mothers today don't love their children at all. It's about themselves. It's, I understand you have an unusual circumstance due to the, you know, the physical stuff that's happening. But mothers don't love their children today. That's why they only want the school doors open so they can use the schools as a daycare center.
Yeah.
And not because they love the children. Because if they love the children, they would stay home and raise the children, the man's children, watch over them and teach them at home. But they don't want to do that.
Yeah, I noticed. And, I mean, I would love to stay home. But like I was telling you, my husband's disabled.
Right. Your husband disabled. And, but I ask. I gave you the same, your husband gave you the same advice I gave you. Why do you trust his advice?
I do trust it. It took me a long time. I was actually thinking about that after we talked the other day on why it took me so long. And the reason it's taking me so long is because I really cannot leave those insurance. And Costco, you know, they have really, really good insurance.
Right.
So that's why it's taken me so long to apply, because, you know, with my husband with health issues, and I'm pretty sure I've told you that I've had health issues. It's hard to, I can't leave that insurance.
Right, I understand.
Stuck.
Yeah, I understand that. And so when your husband had that discussion with you and he said, you know what, you can work closer to home, you can do this and do that, did you explain to him, well, I need the insurance to keep us covered so we both have physical ailments?
Yeah, and I did start talking to the school, trying to get in.
If they hire you, do they have medical coverage for you at the school?
I think it depends on what job you get, because the original one that I applied for was part-time, and they said that it did not come with benefits.
Yeah.
And that's when I decided to apply. I'm like, I want to just talk to him to see how I get benefits or how I go about it.
Right. Normally they don't give part-time workers health benefit, insurance benefit.
Yeah, they don't. And
do
they're
you
like,
trust
oh,
you
can volunteer. Yeah, I do trust him.
You trust him?
He's very wise. You know, now that I listen to you, I realize he's not as beta as I thought he was. He listened to you back in the day. But he's a very independent person. Like, he doesn't care if he talks to his family ever again or has any friends. He's always been that way, too.
Nice.
Like, I'll sit here by myself and live peaceful all on my own. And he's always been that way.
Nice.
And just listening to you, I'm like, oh my gosh, that's crazy.
Well, let me do
this. He's always been on the right track.
I have a guess I need to get to.
Yeah.
Let me do this. You stay with the silent prayer?
I am.
Every morning, every night?
Yep, and even on the drive.
Nice. And, well, stay present. God is here and now. He's not in the future or the past. Stay present and watch. And you'll see it. The more you let go of the imagination, then life will start to work for you naturally. Life happens naturally. We don't have to make it happen.
Yeah. I think that's what's going to happen to the Democratic Party. Is naturally, it's going to be taken out.
Well, I don't know about all that, but I'm just talking about you as an individual right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
Thank you.
I appreciate it, Brandon. Let me know how the job thing and call me again, all right?
I will call you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I wish you well.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys so much.
You're welcome. You too. Thank you for your support. I hung up on him. Thank you, Brandon. I'm sorry. Bill Lockwood is here. Your friend and my friend. And the friend of the world. The light of the world. Bill Lockwood is here. One of the smartest white men on this side of heaven. A writer, preacher, and the host of Patriot Pulpit and Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood on YouTube. Bill is also a preacher at Our Park Church of Christ. Bill.
Good morning.
How you doing, sir?
Great. It's good to talk to you with you, Jesse. Can you hear me all right?
I do. I can. Loud and clear.
Good, good. Yes, yeah, good to be with you.
You have a nice background back there. Real nice.
Oh, yeah. That's part of my library. Yeah.
Nice. So, Bill, you're now, instead of the last Tuesday of the month, you're going to be with us the first Tuesday of the month?
Well, whatever you'd like to do, that's fine. You know what? I started another teaching job at Wichita Christian School in Wichita Falls. So I'm trying to get my feet on the floor and get everything, my schedule organized a little bit differently. But I have one class. So we can still do the last Tuesday of the month. That'd be great. It's just however you all want to do it. That'd
okay,
be great.
Yeah. We'll work it out. You're not doing juvenile detention teaching anymore, right?
No, sir. I retired out of the Wichita Falls ISD.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I am actually teaching in a private school, Wichita Christian School, and it's a ninth grade Bible class. And so I'm doing one class a day, 1 hour a day,
right,
having a great time, great students, great staff, and it's just really a world of difference, night and day from the public school system.
Well, I wish you well with that. So you're feeling well now?
I feel great. I feel good. I feel well. I had troubles last year, but I'm doing all right now. How are you doing?
Amazing.
That's good. Okay. So I like your horse and rider there.
I know, huh?
Yeah, look at that.
This is Country and Western Tuesday.
I like that. That's good. I like that. That's a little G.I. Joe.
it reminded me of when I was a kid growing up in Alabama. I was young. Yeah. And I used to help my father with the farmland and stuff.
Right.
And he gave me two horses, as a matter of fact. And I used to ride them to see my girlfriend on Sunday evenings after church. Oh,
okay.
All kind of stuff. It reminds me of that.
That's good.
Mia, before we get into our subject here, how do you see what's happening in the country right now and the world, but especially in the country?
Well, you know, I'm extremely concerned. I'm afraid that we've lost any kind of moral base in our nation, and that unless we turn back to God, I don't think this country is going to exist as a separate, independent, and strong nation any longer. And what's happening at the top is happening at the bottom, as you know, the topic we're going to talk about here in a few moments, the Burning Man Festival.
Yeah.
But the same thing at the top, same thing at the bottom, and it's just immorality, ungodliness, wickedness. And it's gone to high places, and that's where we are in our country right now. So unless we can turn back to a moral compass and have a moral compass, I think we're doomed as a nation.
Is this something new, or has this always been happening in the world?
Well, it's always happened in the world. We're not any different in America than what's happened all throughout history. So if we take, for example, the Old Testament nation of Israel and what happened to Israel, this was exactly how they went. They would go for good for a while, and then they'd go downhill, then they would be restored and come back. But eventually God said, enough is enough. And he shut the door on Old Testament Israel, and they went to captivity, and they never came back. They came back only under the auspices of the Persian government, then the Roman government took over, and it was never the same.
And that is what's happening in America right now?
Yes, sir.
Amazing. And so it seemed like, you know, because so many people, most people don't want God. They don't want to change.
Right.
They love the hell that they live in. And right. If you even suggest to them that they can overcome it, that they can overcome the hell by returning to the Father, right? They're not going to do it. It just ain't going to happen. And families, friendship, relationships, and all kind of shifts, right?
Right.
What should the individual do in order to survive in a world where most people are not going to change?
Well, every individual for himself needs to be obedient to God and live a life that is in sacrifice to him. And reestablish those basic principles with himself, herself, and their families, and live godly. And something important, though, that and I've been saying this for many, many years in the pulpit, that we have to figure out what is our relationship to the government, because the government is cracking down on Christian people now and is antagonistic and ugly against Christians and Christianity. And it's going to be that way, just as in the country of Canada, just as in the country over in England. And they're cracking down on Christians, they're cracking down on preachers, and so many Christians have become so weak that they don't want this truth spoken, lest it be offensive to someone, unless the government kind of cracks them on the head with it. But we have to be able to figure out how to manage ourselves and speak boldly in these times, because that's the only thing that's going to be is personal salvation. And I don't know that we're going to be able to save the country, but at any rate.
Yeah. Why such an attack upon Christianity and no other religion but Christianity? Why is the attack so major upon Christian?
You know, because as Paul lined out in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 and following, he points out there that the war has always been about God versus Satan. And Satan has operated through the different individuals, different politicians, different emissaries, different agents in the world, and it's always been about satanic powers versus God. That's what it's been about. So it doesn't make any difference if we're talking about Islam, they're against Christianity. It doesn't make any difference if we're talking about communism, it's against Christianity. Christianity and Christ is the one enemy of all of these different worldviews. Christ and him crucified, and Jesus Christ, God in the flesh. And that is the enemy of Islam, that is the enemy of communism, that is the enemy of humanism, that is the enemy of evolutionism. It is the enemy of all of these and more also, because that's where the battle is always. And it has always been right there.
Amazing. So there are other religions, like Judaism, Mormonism, Allahu Abbaism. There are so many other different religions. What made Christianity special?
Because of deity in the flesh, Jesus Christ, Son of God, and he himself fulfilled the Old Testament, and now he is the one to be worshiped and honored. Judaism is opposing Christ itself. Judaism itself says some exceedingly ugly things about Jesus Christ in the Talmud. Judaism today is Talmudism, and Talmudism is against Jesus Christ in a very blasphemous manner. So whether it be Judaism, whether it be Islam, all the same, against Christ, and that's where we are in this country. As a matter of fact, you might notice that a lot of the leading politicians on the left are Jewish individuals, but they are absolutely blasphemous against Jesus Christ.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Can you hold me on? Let me take a break.
Sure.
Okay.
Happy to.
All right. 888-7753-773. 888 877-JESSE. A quick break. One line open at 888-7753-773. Back in a moment. Yee-haw! Amazing. After a while that when these guys overcome their anger, they have amazing ideas about starting a business. But because they've been told that if you don't get a loan from the bank, or if you don't have a 5-year plan, or if you don't do this, and it's just simply not true. It's the first step. With faith, then all things are possible. But the most important thing is to return to the Father. That yearning that you have, that emptiness, that void, is not for more stuff. It's not for more friends. It is a return to the Father, because there's no way you can return to God and be angry at your earthly father. So thank you all so, so much, right? People around the world donated to Bond at RebuildingTheMan.com, or they call 800-411-2663. And we're still committed to pointing the right way for men and women to return to the Father.
Out here on the road, and our love takes center stage. Every single show, but lately you've been distant. I don't know what for. Something's changed, you can't see my face in the crowd no more. Something's changed, you can't see my face in the crowd no more.
Country and Western Tuesday. 888-7753-773. Quick announcements. Then we'll get back to Bill Lockwood and your phone calls. The Hake Report is coming up at the top of this hour. TheHakeReport.com from 9 to 11 a.m. Pacific time. And right after the Hake Report, Joel Friday TV. He black. Joel Friday every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Pacific time, and at 12 noon, the American Anchor Baby. The American Anchor Baby at 12 noon Pacific time, all right? It's amazing. And don't forget the Misform this Thursday at 7 p.m. every first Thursday night for men only. And third Thursday night for ladies only, Sunday morning, everybody and their mama. We are building this 24-hour talk network with all men, 24 hours. So tomorrow at 11 a.m., a new edition, Hassan, Wow Hassan, W-O-W, Walking on Water Hassan, and his dog at 11 a.m. tomorrow, all right? Pacific time. And don't forget to donate and have your comments read out loud. BuyMeACoffee.com/JLP Talk and Bond JLP Cash App. And we're going to get to all your super chats here in a minute. I want to go quickly back to Bill Lockwood. And we're going to tell you, Bill, tell the folks how to get to your website and all the stuff you're doing before we get started here again.
Sure. Thank you for that, Jesse.
Okay.
Well, the website is still AmericanLibertyWithBillLockwood.com. And that website is there. I don't post articles on it right now, but it is there for people if they want to donate to the program. There's a donate button there. The program, however, is a podcast now. And I'm not on the radio, but I'm on the, and it's a podcast called Patriotic Pulpit, patrioticpulpit.com. And I'm on Amazon Music app, It's also on the Spotify app as well. So those are the two apps that I'm on. Plus, we have YouTube. I have a lot of shorts on YouTube from that podcast. But my sermons are Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood, and I preach every Sunday and teach classes there. So I'm teaching on Revelation, the book of Revelation right now, and finishing that one up. But anyway, those are all on Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood.
Okay, well, we'll give it out again before you leave.
Sure.
I want to ask which is greater, the threat from within the country or the threat from outside of the country?
Within.
And explain.
Well, you know what? If just like an individual, if an individual is equipped with the word of God and has put on the full armor of God, as Ephesians chapter 6 teaches, then that person is invincible. Now, he or she may be killed for Christ, but that person is invincible to apostasy and falling away and being driven away. But if on the inside we have accepted principles and ideas and concepts that are contrary to Jesus Christ, that begins to erode our faith, and we become very, very weak, and we become people that are really, we don't mirror Jesus Christ at all. And that's what's happening to the churches. So you take a cross section of the churches now, you don't see anything such as what was going on in the New Testament. So the same thing, in my view, regarding an individual is the same thing regarding the country as a whole. As long as we were faithful and if we can remain faithful and become faithful again to the principles of Christ and morality and a moral compass in our nation, then we are invincible as a people. But once that corrosion begins and we allow it to go on steroids as it has, then we are going to crumble within, and we are just an empty shell of what we were. And that will not be very difficult for anything to take down.
Amazing.
Besides that, God will bring about punishment for us if we're going to be so unfaithful as we have become.
Amazing. I know we got started late here. We were supposed to start at the top of the hour, but there was some problem with it.
That was my fault. You know what? I was trying to figure out some technological difficulties, but your staff is great. They helped me through it. Said, here's what you need to do. So anyway.
Nice.
Yeah.
But I want to get to this Burning Man Music Festival in Nevada. And can you tell the folk, and then I want to play a soundbite from it so that people can see it that might not be aware of it. But tell the people, what is the Burning Man Music Festival?
Well, the Burning Man Music Festival is a hedonistic, no-holds-barred debauch. It is where people are ugly and anti-Christian and pro-Satan and as one news article put it, a drug-addled festival. It's like Woodstock on steroids itself. It's Woodstock that is blown wide open. And it was started by Larry Harvey. He actually started it. He's an artist, but he himself was a humanist, did not believe in God. He himself was a leftist. And so he started in San Francisco on the beach burning an effigy of a man, a little wooden statue, burning it. And they had a number of people in 1986 that gathered around and they celebrated it. But he himself came out of what was called the Cacophony Society, which is really a discordant type of society where they're trying to break up society. And there's everything against the man, everything against society, everything against the what's going on in our country, and the hate, kind of a hate America type thing. And so the Cacophony Society kind of blossomed into this, and he came from that background. So he started the Burning Man 1986 on the beaches of San Francisco. And soon enough, there's so many people that were there. The idea of being a free spirit and a radical self-expression is one of his principles. That, of course, simply means there's no holds barred. There's nothing right, nothing wrong. So, for example, they've had this. And they have like 60 to 80,000 people now going to Burning Man and have for the last number of years in the Black Rock Desert of Nevada. And they have celebrated Satan. They've celebrated sex. They've celebrated homosexuality. They've had incidences where they had in 2001, for example, what was called the Jiffy Lube incident. They have a whole camp that was dedicated to homosexuals, or homosexuals set it up. And they have a Jiffy Lube incident where they had I'm trying to tiptoe through how to word it without being so offensive in how, but they had two men performing homosexual acts in a model that was put up somewhere. And so evidently someone complained about it. And so the law enforcement got involved in it. But Larry Harvey came on and he said, in a blog site, he said, you know, it doesn't violate the principles of Burning Man because this is radical self-expression. But I can see how some people might, you know, not, but he kind of tried to pour oil on the waters. But basically, it doesn't violate the principles of Burning Man. One individual had been there from a Christian society said, you know, it was a horrific, hellish display where they celebrated Satan. They mocked Christianity. They mocked Jesus Christ. They had effigies of an Elvis that had been crucified supposedly for your sins and that kind of thing. And they prayed to Satan, and it was just a hellish event. And that's what Burning Man is. It's just completely off the charts wickedness.
You said that he was is he still living?
Larry Harvey died, I think, in 2018. He died in 2000, but it is carried on by other individuals. But he had a LLC corporation that he established. And here's something else frightening. Jesse, the National Endowment for the Arts, which is funded by tax monies from you and me, actually granted Burning Man LLC, they granted them money. So in other words, our tax money funneled through the National Endowment for the Arts gave money to Burning Man. So you are helping sponsor. I'm helping sponsor, through this wicked system of taxation we have in our country, the Burning Man event, even though it is celebrating Satan and denigrating Jesus Christ and celebrating homosexuality. And that's what's happening in our country. So that shows us a little bit where we are.
And you say that this guy was a humanist?
Right. He was a human. His followers.
What's
said
a humanist?
He was a humanist. The Humanist Manifesto, number one, was signed in 1933. It came out of the Progressive Era, which was basically communistic era, and it relied upon Darwinism as the explanation for the origin of life. So humanists are those who say there is no God. If you're going to say be saved, you have to save yourself. And ethics are autonomous and situational. So your ethics and your ethical standard arises from within you. What you think is right is right. What I think is right is right. If I think something's wrong, it doesn't have anything to do with you. And so ethics are situational, depending upon the situation, and autonomous, arising from myself alone. Me, myself, and I determine what are morals. So that is humanism. So the first Humanist Manifesto, signed in 1933 by such people as John Dewey, who was the father of American education. John Dewey signed the Humanist Manifesto. The second one was put out in 1973, and then there was a third one in 2000. So there's a magazine called The Humanist. It was edited by Paul Kurtz, and he was a humanist himself. So humanism is there's no God. We decide ourselves what is right and what is wrong.
Amazing. Yeah. I want to play for the folks. We have a clip showing what Burning Man is. Watch this compilation, folks.
Okay.
You know, I remember, so Bill, I remember when I was younger, they used to have the hippie thing like that.
Yeah.
Well, that's the same thing.
Right. Basically the same thing, except much worse at this point.
So the hip, but so the Burning Man Festival, music festival, for those who were not watching, they were burning, they were showing this festival thing, they had this piece of wood burning and a whole bunch of stuff. So the Burning Man Festival is the same thing as Woodstock when the white people were doing all the hippie stuff?
Yeah, basically, that's correct, yeah.
I thought when I was young and I saw the white people doing the hippie stuff out in the desert, I just thought they were out there having fun. I would think, wow, white people are kind of weird out there.
Oh, yeah, you know what? But, you know, it was all about throwing off the moral restraints of society. And so in the 1960s, Woodstock was not simply about just enjoying music. It was about resisting society's moral standards. That's what it was about.
Oh.
And the people there, such as the Abbie Hoffmans of the world who were in the hippie movement, they absolutely were opposed to the police, just like Black Lives Matter. They hated the cops. They were anti-cop. But when Abbie Hoffman got his apartment robbed, he himself called who? He called the police. It's just this same hypocrisy that goes on now.
Yeah.
But the same thing is going on here today. It's the same thing.
I thought that they were against the war. That's why they were doing it.
Well, I think that was part of it, but that was not the only thing it was about.
Oh, okay.
Not simply about the war.
Right.
But it's interesting that communism infiltrated that movement because the communists were those who were against the war because we were opposing communism in Vietnam. Even though people had a hard time understanding what it was all about, we were opposing communism in Vietnam. So our soldiers, of course, they did oppose that. But nevertheless, it was also about throwing off any kind of moral restraints. As a matter of fact, they had a Port Huron statement in 1962, which started off this hippie movement in which they basically stated in a formal document that here's what we're against. And that was about the morals of America and Christian morality. They hated them. They were opposing them. And that's what got this thing all started. So that was the hippie movement. Yeah, it was not simply, okay, hey, so all of our young people, they were simply ignorant and their parents were ignorant about what they were getting involved in. So they let their hair grow long and they wore bell bottoms. They wanted to hear music, but it was really about throwing off the yoke of Christianity and the moral standards that we knew.
The salon.com is reporting that every summer at the end of August, thousands of people from around the world make their pilgrimage to the countercultural festival called Burning Man. Some come for a spiritual awakening, some merely to party and indulge. What started as a small gathering in 1986 has been refashioned as a major event drawing more than 75,000 festival goers to the Black Rock Desert, 2 hours north of Reno, Nevada. But recently, Bill, at this particular one, it rained heavily. So it kind of messed up their party. This is from Breitbart. The Burning Man Festival took a turn for the worse on Saturday when heavy rainfall caused unprecedented flooding, closing roads and leaving attendees stranded in the muddy desert. Watch this from NBC, folks.
The entire place is absolutely just soaked.
After 2 days of heavy rainfall left more than 70,000 trapped in thick mud in the middle of the remote Nevada desert.
Driving a vehicle right now is impossible. There is absolutely no way you could move a vehicle through this right now.
The local sheriff's office now probing the death of one person during the rain event. The cause still under investigation. But the festival says the death was not storm related. The unprecedented downpour started Friday. Festival organizers telling burners to shelter in place and to conserve food, water, and fuel while closing roads both in and out of the playa.
And then the rain came, Bill, to wipe away that mess.
You know, one report I read said that it was only a half inch of rain. But, you know, if you live in the desert, like I'm from Phoenix, and if you got a half inch of rain, it floods. or if you get an inch of rain, it floods. People don't understand that in the South because, you know, I moved to Montgomery and you're from that area. Yeah. So, you know, you get like, you can get a 6-inch drop in one weekend and, you know, okay, you're going to get about your business. But you get that kind of rain in the desert, you're in serious trouble. And that's what happened out there in the playa.
That's amazing. Yeah. So, Bill, and it's amazing how this time gone by. What causes things to repeat itself? Because during the hippie movement, when they were doing all that stuff, at that time they had the Black Star Ranger and those black radical groups happening then as well, while the white people were doing their little thing at the festival and whatever else, right?
Yeah, except for Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah. What causes history to repeat itself over and over and over again?
Well, I suppose, Jesse, that's the nature of man. To minds like water seek the lowest level. Unless we become godly, unless we turn to Christ and seek higher ground, then we just devolve. And so as we see one generation from another generation in the book of Judges, they just went downward, downward, downward until they were worshiping idols. And that's exactly what they're doing at Burning Man, incidentally. Yeah. They worship idols. And so the same thing happened in the book of Judges. So then they had punishment from other nations that God sent in. They reformed, they repented, and they came back to God. And then they started going downhill again. But this is the very reason the founding fathers put into place the limited government that we have, because they didn't want the government run by men to go so degraded that it would now be crush men in the rights and liberties. But that's exactly what's happened. But that's another story, I know, for another day. But that's simply the nature of men, that they were going to seek out the lowest level unless we actually become righteous and turn to Christ and go and seek a higher ground.
And that is a big way that is happening. We showed the different festival way back then, and it's happening now. But I noticed that someone can commit a murder, right?
Right.
And they go to prison and they're punished and they say they would never do it again. But record shows that as soon as they get out, most of the time repeat offenders repeat the same thing and they are back in prison again. Is that the same as these festivals and what's happening? Is that the same kind of thing?
I think so. I think that's a good illustration, really. Because there's only one thing that changes a person, and that is his heart has to change.
Yes.
And that is done by Jesus Christ. And if he doesn't, a person's heart is not changed, then there's no change on the outward. So
absolutely.
Yeah. And that's what's happening. You're right.
The heart has to change. Ain't nothing else going to change. You could say until the cows come home, I would never do that again. I would never, never, ever do it. But if the heart doesn't change, you're going to do it again.
Right. Amazing. You have to repent. Yeah, you have to repent.
Yeah.
Yeah, before you come to Christ.
We're out of time. Tell the folks how to get to you again and your websites and whatever you want to put out there.
Hey, thank you so much, Jesse. Enjoy being with you today. So the radio show, actually a podcast, is Patriotic Pulpit. Patriotic Pulpit, and that is on Amazon Music app as well as the Spotify app as well. So those are the two apps. Patriotic Pulpit is the podcast. And then my sermons are on Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood, and you can find that. I'm at the Iowa Park Church of Christ. Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood. You can have my sermons, Bible classes, all that kind of material. And then, of course, the website to support what I do is American Liberty with Bill Lockwood. And then there's a button there that you can use that to donate.
Nice. Bill, thank you. I'm glad we was able to get you today on here.
Thank you so much for having me.
We're out, and we'll see you soon, man.
Looking forward to it, Jesse. Thank you so much.
All right, buddy.
Love you.
Love you too, and I'm glad you're getting back on track again.
Sir. Thank you so much. Looking forward to next month.
All right.
You bet.
Take care.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye.
Bye now. Amazing. Bill Lockwood, folks, so check it out. Patriot Pulpit on YouTube and Bible Studies with Bill Lockwood, all right? Amazing. Let me see, could I get a first-time caller, Andrew, and out of New Jersey. Andrew, real fast, you're on the air. Oh, Andrew.
Jesse, you're a legend, man. Thank you so much, man. I love and appreciate you, bro.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, for real, man.
Yeah, I was just listening, and I appreciate everything you said about the Burning Man, man. You know, your boy missed a couple things about...
Andrew, just to be kind to you, man, will you call? Are you able to call me tomorrow or anytime soon?
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know, I know you're probably about to cut off right now. Definitely, right. I'd love to speak to you, man.
Okay,
I'll give you a call back later this week, bro.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate it.
Well, really, stay blessed, man. I really appreciate the work you do, man.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, man. Thank you. I gotta go. The Hake Report is coming up now. And after the Hake Report, Joel Fry, the TV, he black. And after that, the American Anchor Baby. Get on that straight and narrow, folks. Stay there. No matter what, you stay there, you stay there, you stay there. And when you're done, all you can do to stay there some more. No matter who turned against you, no matter what happened. I'm telling you, and blow your mind. Do the silent prayer, www.silentprayer.video. Forgive your mama and your daddy. Forgive both. Your mama, too, especially the mama. The hell came through her. From her mama to you, and so on. Nick out of South Carolina, Rutherford Ford out of Texas, and the callers that are hanging out, I'll be back tomorrow, Manhood Hours tomorrow. Have a good one, folks. Hake Report is coming up now. The Hake, and we'll do the Super Chats tomorrow, too. I see them tomorrow. Thank you for them. Have a good one.
I had to get on the track one time. Joel Friday here. Look, stand up. Stand up, we got fighting to do. We gotta show him who boss. He put a Viking in you. He put that lightning in you. Igniting the truth. But you beg and blame and lie and hate and never wanna stand for the truth. So what you planning to do? You understand in the loop. You better go talk to your mama. Better stop with the drama. Better drop all the trauma. Boy, you better stand up and up. Put your hand up and hut. Cause if you don't, then we lose. And then we gotta hear the fake news. Whoa. So you get something went wrong, but face the truth about yourself and just seek first God's kingdom. Cause I know we can find a way. You must know that self, so you get.
So, here's what I recommend. I invite you to download my silent prayer, and I want you to start doing it. You just download it, get the points of how to do it, and then after a while, you just do it on your own. It's going to point you in the right direction that your life will be returned to you from God. He will give you your life back, because anyone and all people who has anger, they're not themselves. You are the person that you are angry at. That's why it's so important to get to know yourself so that you can see who you're angry at. And if you're doing the hooping and hollering prayers and things like that, some people get up, oh, praise the Lord, hoop and holler, bless my mama, bless my daddy. Continue to do it. Do both. You will see if you want to stay with the hooping and hollering or do you want to be still and know God. So my gift to you, no charge, at rebuildingtheman.com/church. I noticed after a while that when these guys overcome their anger, they have amazing ideas about starting a business. But because they've been told that if you don't get a loan from the bank, or if you don't have a 5-year plan, or if you don't do this, and it's just simply not true, it's the first step
With faith, then all things are possible. So, but the most important thing is to return to the Father. That yearning that you have, that emptiness, that void, is not for more stuff. It's not for more friends. It is a return to the Father, because there's no way you can return to God and be angry at your earthly father. So thank you all so, so much, right? People around the world donated to Bond at rebuildingtheman.com, or they call 800-411-2663. And we're still committed to pointing the right way for men and women to return to the Father.